early integration of palliative care into mainstream oncology practice. So to begin with, we'll start with the basic, that is, what exactly palliative care means. Is my screen visible?
Not yet, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, now it's visible.
Okay, thank you. So palliative care is basically an approach which improves the quality of life of patients and their families who are inflicted by a terminal illness. And often it is confused with hospice care. So if you can see in the image, hospice care is in fact a subset of palliative care. And although both of them work towards improving the quality of life of terminally ill patients, yet palliative care has a wider base, considering that palliative care can be given at any stage of the disease, ideally starting from diagnosis. Whereas hospice care starts towards the end of life, when the life expectancy of the patient is less than 6 months. Also, during palliative care, the patient could be receiving simultaneously life-prolonging treatment. But with hospice care, all those options have already been exhausted. So to understand the need of palliative care, in Asia alone, in 2018, 8.7 million new cases of cancer were diagnosed. And more than 64% of the global burden of palliative care is in our region. And unfortunately, palliative care is not accessible by most people in need. So this is an image which illustrates the demand as to supply discrepancy. And to understand the reality, we have our palliative care center at Pune, which is a facility which provides free of cost world-class palliative care since the past 23 years. So we dug out our data and we found that even out of the patients admitted to our center, more than 60% die within 1 week. Whereas we have other services like outpatient, home care, and even out of those registered patients, more than 40% die within 45 days of registration. So this just reiterates the fact that patients are being referred to palliative care towards the end of the disease trajectory. And early referrals is the biggest challenge that we face today, in spite of providing free service. So I would like to highlight how early integration of palliative care would be helpful to oncologists. So firstly, it leads to better compliance to treatment. The symptoms of the patient, the pain, as well as the psychological issues associated with this life-shattering diagnosis is managed with the help of the palliative care team, and that leads to better compliance, which obviously leads to better treatment-related outcomes. Also, since the team is continuously in touch with the patient and the family, it leads to better follow-up, better patient satisfaction, and ultimately better quality of life. So in short, we are here to unburden the symptoms like pain and psychosocial issues so that oncologists like yourself can focus on the curative aspect of the illness. To reaffirm that early palliative care improves outcomes, we did a review of literature. We found n number of studies which stated this fact, and I've picked out a handful which show that it improves the quality of life, it reduces depression, it improves the survival rate. Most important, according to us, is that it's associated with fewer emergency room visits and fewer hospitalizations towards the end of life. This shows that the patient, as well as the family, are quite well prepared towards the end. So that leads to the million-dollar question that we keep just diagnosed. Should it be once the curative treatment is over and the patient is stable now? Or should it be towards the end of life? So frankly speaking, there is no right or wrong answer. But considering all the facts that I've mentioned till now, it's important to actively think about it. The only thing is that ongoing treatment and palliative care are not necessarily contradictory. In fact, they should go hand in hand. So the ideal model has been laid down by Dr. Robert Zweikross, in which he mentions that whenever the patient is diagnosed, disease-modifying therapy and supportive care, they start simultaneously. As the disease progresses, the role of the disease-modifying therapy will reduce, whereas that of supportive or palliative care goes on increasing, whereas at a point of time, the patient completely shifts on to palliative care. So our aim is to make this shift seamless. So how do we try to do it? So we have a multidisciplinary team at our center, which includes the doctor, pain specialist, social worker, nutritionist, physiotherapist, nurses, and volunteers. We also have home care, where we cater to patients in the comfort of their home, as well as we conduct outpatient clinics at hospitals across the city where oncology practice is prevalent. So we still have a lot of challenges for early referral. In spite of providing care according to the choice of the patient, free of cost, yet we have a lot of challenges which we have identified. So the most important challenge that we think is if palliative care is unfortunately misconstrued as end-of-life care. Secondly, patients are reluctant to accept palliative care because they feel that it means that now nothing can be done and now this is the end of the road. We also interviewed a few oncologists and they felt that referring to palliative care gives them a sense of abandonment or giving up or actually sort of not being aggressive enough. Also, early integration of palliative care into oncology would require expertise in terms of palliative care physicians knowing the chemotherapy regimens, the common side effects, prognostication. So that is limited, which needs to be worked upon. And also there might be a misalignment in the communication. So the oncology team and the palliative care team might communicate in very different languages to the patient, which would lead to misalignment. So to overcome these challenges, the American Society for Clinical Oncology has laid down certain guidelines, and they say that patients with advanced cancer should receive dedicated palliative care early, preferably within 8 weeks of diagnosis, and all patients with a high symptom burden should get palliative care, and also caregiver-tailored palliative care support should be provided. So this was provided by the ASCO. And based on our 23 years of experience, we have thought of a few solutions. So firstly, integration rather than referral. So if the palliative care physician is embedded into the oncology team right from day one, it develops a good rapport with the patient. He's aware of the entire course of the illness. His involvement could change as per the needs of the patient at every step of his illness. The most important thing this would achieve is there won't be a feeling of abandonment when transition to palliative care takes place, whenever that happens. And always, the treating physician remains in charge. So the sense of abandonment for the physician also will not exist.
Ma'am, 2 minutes left.
Yeah. We can also rename palliative care as best supportive care. In fact, this was one of the suggestions which was given by an oncologist himself. So we are thinking of, this could also be done. Early integration will also help with that. Good coordination between both the teams will ensure that there is seamless transition and goals of care are discussed. The communication will be on the same page. Also, specialized training, which is undertaken by oncologists and palliative care physicians together, would help in training both of them. The palliative care physicians in terms of oncology as well as oncologists in terms of the latest advances in pain management and palliative care. So we are currently running the IMPACT training course along with the SAARC Federation of Oncologists. So this is one of these courses, as well as there are many more such courses which we are taking. Also joint research to see how integrated approach will lead to excellence in cancer care. So I would like to end with, if I have to live just one day in my life, it should be the best day of my life. And that's what we aim to do through palliative care. So thank you very much for your patient listening. I would now like to hand over to Rumana. I'm delighted to welcome her. She's the managing trustee of Cipla Foundation. She leads the foundation's strategy and growth. Palliative care is a flagship legacy commitment for the foundation, and Rumana is actively involved in spearheading the palliative care vision as the trustee of the Cipla Palliative Care Center in Pune. Welcome, Rumana. Over to you to take the panel forward.
Thank you, Dr. Nivedita. I'm very, very happy to be here today. Thank you for your excellent session. happy to moderate this session with an esteemed panel of doctors who deliver exceptional palliative care. Looking forward to exploring over the next 30 minutes how we can achieve early integration. If we have that common understanding that we must integrate, then our esteemed panel can help us integrate and find a path forward together, as you say. But before we begin, I'd like to introduce all of you to our panelists. We have Dr. Maryanne Mukaddam. She is a pioneer in setting up the palliative care unit at the Tata Memorial Hospital and an ardent champion for pediatric palliative care. We have Dr. Nandini Ralat. She has worked extensively in creating awareness about the accessibility of the safe use of opioids across the country. She has worked closely in the Northeast in setting up integrated cancer care centers. Dr. Parikh has also been an HOD at the TMH Oncology Department for over 17 years and has a wealth of experience in patient-centered care. Dr. Naveen Salins has set up the palliative care services at Manipal Academy of Higher Education. He is passionate about promoting evidence-based palliative care. Dr. Ranade has been the past president of the Indian Society of Medicine and Pediatric Oncology and is an author of several books and journal articles. Welcome, everybody. A very warm welcome and thank you for being with us today. My first question is to Dr. Maryanne. Dr. Maryanne, considering that you were a pioneer in setting up the Department of Palliative Medicine at TMH and instrumental also in starting the MD program, could you please throw light on what was your vision for early integration of palliative care and your experience in working towards this?
Thanks, Romana. Thanks very much to the organizers and to Cipla Foundation for organizing this session. So for those who do not know this, I'm a radiation oncologist. So I'm an oncologist first. And the reason that I got into palliative care, and I'm a palliative care physician first, was because I saw the suffering of so many patients with advanced cancer. So if you think of a patient with advanced cancer and you think of the suffering, you definitely feel that, well, they've already undergone a certain trajectory of illness, but there's still a long trajectory left. And the oncologists have so many other curable patients to concentrate on, and therefore it needs someone else to do the best supportive care. And though I'm not a proponent of that word best supportive care, because I think the word palliative care is actually such a beautiful word. It actually means to support and to care for. However, if you have a team of palliative care experts in an oncology setup, then there's a very smooth transition. So from curative, when you're trying to cure the patient and you're kind of realizing it's not happening, if the palliative care physicians come in at that point of time, and if some members of the team are oncologists, then they can understand what's happening with the patient as the cancer, but they can also understand what's happening with the patient as, you know, for the supportive care, for the holistic care, for the psychological and social and spiritual distress. And obviously, if we say that, then, you know, if we come in, as Nivedita was saying, in the last week of life, how much time do we have to help the patient and the family understand the distress, help the distress, and change that into something which, as we know, the stages of grief that the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross has put, that from going from denial to acceptance, and we know that they don't go from denial to acceptance, they go through the stages, and when they've finished the bargaining and they've maybe had depression, they'll go into acceptance, but the next morning they're back into denial. Again, time. So how are we going to give time to patient and family to come to an acceptance that their life is finite and that they can live maybe 20 years of their life within those 2 months or 2 years is what makes, I think, the huge difference. So obviously, if we come in at a time when we know that the disease is either relapsed or recurrent or just there and not going away, then along with the oncologist, the palliative care physicians could, you know, hold hands and help the patient to understand, and those are the goals of palliative care, to understand that death is part of living. So we're not worried about the death. We don't want the patient to die. We want the patient to live for whatever time is left for that patient. And we want the family to also be able to accept the situation so that once the patient has passed on, they are not in a very abnormal grieving, but they are able to grieve and they're able to move on. So that's why I feel as an oncologist, I understand very clearly that the transition should be made very smooth for the patient. And the only way we can do that is if the palliative care people can work along with the oncologist. And I'll be really happy to again share one small little, another understanding that we talk about generalist palliative care and specialist palliative care. So my understanding of that is that every oncologist should have an understanding of what are the principles of palliative care, because they unfortunately, I think it gets passed on to the patient that the oncologist also feels that palliative care means end of life care. So they don't want to, you know, call in the palliative care people because they feel that the patient is going to think that, oh, the oncologist says, sorry, but you're going to die. And therefore, I think that understanding should come if everybody had an awareness of what palliative care was about, that it's not just end of life care, that it is making the rest of the patient's life as easy as possible and bringing them into a gradual acceptance. If they could understand that, then I do not think that we need to use words like best supportive care. I think we could still use the word palliare, which is where palliative care is gleaned from, as someone to cloak, to support, to care for, to give compassion, and to help the person to reach the end of life with the best possible time left for them. Thanks, Romana.
Thank you, Dr. Marian.
Let me just intervene. Can I just ask, there are two people here from Tata, and there's one person who's probably all the participants are his students. So Purvi sir and then Ranade sir, just comment about this.
So I think Marianne has done a fantastic job of describing exactly what is to be done. Unfortunately, the challenge that I feel comes when there is a conflict within the family. The patient wants something and the relatives want something else. So they are not accepting the same goal. So I would just like to add to what Marianne has said, is that we have to work together so that the family understands and has a common goal. I think that is what I would like to add. And over to Pushan Pranadi. Pranadi is frozen, I think.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Can you? Yeah. Thanks, Amit, and thanks, Sarth, for getting me here. This I would like to point out something else. You know, as Purvish said, and as Mary has very clearly said, that we have to have oncologists with understanding of the subject. I feel we also have to have the oncologists who feel for it. In the sense, the oncologists themselves do not feel that the patient should be referred for palliative care. And that is the biggest problem. We all, as oncologists in general, we keep on telling the patients, yes, there is some hope. In palliative care, we do not mean that there is no hope. It's a better way of living. And as she rightly put it, it's a much better word than best supportive care. So what I feel we really need is we really have to have people who believe in palliative care. And I entirely agree that the data also suggests, which has come from around 2007, that early integration of palliative care in oncology helps the outcome in many, many ways. It saves a lot of money. It gives a better quality of life to the patient. And the entire burden on our teams is reduced. The challenge here is, how do we integrate the palliative care people in our day-to-day practice? That is my bigger concern.
Thank you, Dr. Ranade. You've really outlined how palliative care teams can add value to oncologists by providing better care to patients. And we do recognize that that remains the most, that integration with between palliative care specialists and oncologists remains the most challenging territory for all of us. I'd like to ask Dr. Naveen, you have recently published an article by reviewing the barriers to this integrated care. Could you talk about that and how you have seen barriers can be overcome in your own practice?
Thank you, Rumana, for that question. Recently, we published a systematic review in a Q1 journal where we looked at views of oncologists and hematologists on referral to palliative care, because hematologists and oncologists are the gatekeepers who would probably decide. And just the speakers from the oncology forum have just mentioned that the oncologist should feel for it. And if they do not feel for it, there would not be a palliative care referral. So we wanted to know what are the views of the gatekeepers in terms of a referral happening to palliative care or not happening. And there are many points that has come. It's probably beyond the purview of this discussion to discuss all the points, but some of the key points is that they feel that there is a conflict in their role, because you know they always feel that they should cure the illness or save the patient. And sometimes there is this perception of referring to palliative care means either you are letting down the patient or it is a failure on the professional side. Also, there is this degree of abandonment, which they feel that the patients and families would experience. There could be also this break in the therapeutic relationship. When I say break in therapeutic relation, they know that patient for a while now. In cancer care, it is months to years of relationship and suddenly moving from one thing to another. And also somewhere they feel that it is like it's symbolizing that loss of hope. And maybe their role is always to motivate and give confidence for the patient. But here referring means that you're saying that nothing can be done and you're going to palliative care. And also it is a big emotional decision, not just for the families, but also for the oncologists, because they also feel that when they're referring, it's like they're just letting go and they're not able to help the patient. And sometimes they also feel that they can also do the same job what palliative care people are doing. And there is this constant need probably also to have some control over the patient at all trajectories of the illness. And one of the important findings this review had come is that the oncologist felt that probably palliative care physicians may not have the same level of clinical expertise or competencies, and that the trust in the competencies of the palliative care providers were also less among oncologists. And one of the major barrier, if you look at, is the stigma. The name which Nivedita brought out in her initial presentation is the stigma associated with the term palliative care. Maybe more in the Western setup compared to us, but there is this public stigma associated where palliative care is associated with terminal illness, end of life, and an inclination about not to use the term. That's why this term best supportive care or comfort care or other things that comes into play. And also there are certain organizational challenges, like certain hospitals or cancer care setting, there is this culture of cure. So that also could be an influence. What are the peers are practicing? Per se, palliative care resources itself is very limited. Not every cancer center or every place has enough palliative care resources. And there is also, which another point which Nivedita brought out was misalignment in communication, what we call incongruent communication, because oncologists fear that the palliative care providers will go and tell something to the patient which may be completely different to what is their view or perception, and they may not have that enough knowledge of cancer to communicate. So these are certain, according to me, challenges that comes in place for referral.
Can I ask a question, Naveen?
Can I? Okay.
There is a tremendous amount of palliative care expertise and centers in the state of Kerala as opposed to the rest of India. Yes, what is the reason why this dichotomy?
So,
Purvish, can I answer you?
Sure.
Okay, sure. Sure, go ahead.
So, I feel although there are tremendous what we call resources in Kerala, most of the resources are present as islands outside the hospital. They are not situated within the hospital, within the cancer center where the action is taking place. That cannot create a true integration. When you have palliative care centers outside the hospital, you are not working closely with the oncologist. And integrated palliative care is where you work closely in tandem with the oncologist. So it's not just having the resources, it is how those resources are used, I feel, is more important.
So you are saying the exact opposite of my question. Yes, why are there not enough resources in the rest of the country as there are in Kerala?
Why there are not enough resources? Yeah. So I feel that maybe it is a very community-initiated approach in Kerala, where they have this network neighborhood program, where the community has taken the identified the need and found the need. So that's why the more and more are situated within the community than in the hospital. So that is the primary reason why, whereas in other communities might not have felt the same need.
Purvish, I am going to make a statement which is going to be very controversial. I know that. But the reason is, I think in Christianity, serving somebody who's suffering has a lot of value, and that itself probably is there at Kerala and is not there with us. Point number one. Point number two is in our curriculum, which we have for DM or MCH, or whenever we talk about oncology, we talk about surgery, medical oncology, and radiation. We never talk about palliation. And as I remember, when I was at TMH, Mary was working for palliation since then. We still haven't got, say, a 3 months term or a 6 months term in our curriculum. And lastly, but importantly, communication skills. I think if oncologists are communicating themselves to the patients, this particular transition that we are talking about would be a lot easier. And I still feel that in the minds of oncologists, we all keep on thinking that, "Arre yaar, palliation hai, jaane do, fir chhod do." You know, that attitude itself is wrong. Patients also, Amish had just sent a message that they Google the word palliation and come back to you and say, no, we don't want end of life. So I think we have to take a lot of efforts to, you know, erase that image that palliation is equal to end of life care. I think those are the important points. Mary, you were trying to say something.
I was saying that I think it would depend on the oncologist. Let every oncologist ask the management to have at least unit of palliative care. Never mind about MD and teaching, but all oncologists should ask the management to have a unit of palliative care.
See, that is possible in tertiary care hospitals in
anywhere.
But we don't have those many hospitals. How will you say that it has to be integrated? We don't even have them.
So
as Purvish mentioned, yes, Kerala has it.
We could have one unit of palliative care servicing 5 hospitals. It's okay. But the point is, if the oncologist doesn't want the palliative care physician, then we're never going
exactly.
to come up.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
you
exactly.
guys have to ask for us rather than we going on asking you.
Yeah. That's very true, Dr. Marianne. So thank you, Marianne, for stating it. I'd like to ask Dr. Parekh, since we are talking about this, Dr. Marianne has raised that oncologists are not referring their patients or to palliative care, or oncologists are not saying, you know, to someone like us, "Come train my nurses, make them generalists in palliative care." One thing I learned from Marianne is that everyone can be a generalist and learn the basics of palliative care, on pain scales, on pain management, so that everyone in your team, led by you, is somebody who's sensitive to the larger needs of the patient. So, Dr. Parekh, I'd like to ask you, as a someone who's respected in this field, how could you integrate the two streams together? Because with all your years of experience at a tertiary hospital, of course, but how does it integrate in your practice? Can you share light on that?
I think that's a very important question. Fortunately, Marianne and I both were working at Tata Hospital, so I never felt the deficiency or inadequacy of not having a palliative care specialist. But now that I'm at Shalvi Group of Hospitals and we have 11 centers across India, I feel that there is a tremendous deficiency or inadequacy, because after a certain point, oncologist that is treating patients either has no time or feels at a loss of expertise as far as dealing with palliative care is concerned. And so I fully endorse the need for having a palliative care specialist or a palliative care department at every center, which is Center for Excellence or a Comprehensive Cancer Center across India or South Asia.
So, Panip, Purvesh, have you got palliative people in your institutions?
Fortunately, at 4 out of the 11 centers, we do have palliative care.
Wonderful.
But
excellent.
Let's hope it comes to all the 11
right,
soon.
Right,
yes.
Right.
So I'd like to ask Dr. Nandini, actually, because she's somebody who's been actively involved in initiating palliative care, especially within the government. You know, Dr. Purvesh, when you say it doesn't exist, this is somebody who's gone and done it and integrated palliative care, especially in an area like the Northeast. So actively involved different stakeholders. We'd love to hear from you, Dr. Nandini.
Thank you, Rumana. So you specifically asked for government and my work in Assam, right? So yeah. In government sector, we need to remember that the pitch that we make regarding palliative care is very different when it comes to NGO sector, private sector, and government sector. In the NGO sector, the fact that patient is suffering and we need to do something about it works. If we bring the same point into a private sector, they agree with you, but they may not extend support because their parameters are different. So there the fact would be more like, how many beds can be released because of adequate early symptom control so that they can, you know, use it for direct oncology. So the economics are understood better when we talk in those terms. And also ICU morbidity mortality is an important index for them. So the way we present the idea of symptom management will be the predominant aspect, not about end of life or about suffering and doing good. It is more about good medical practice and which is useful to the department. Now, coming to government sector, I gave the point of view from the other two to make, you know. So in government, there is no person or a group of people that we can convince because it's all officials and the officials may change. So initially, you may work hard with one person for, say, 1 year and the policies are just coming through and then the person gets changed and you are again dealing with someone new. So we need to remember that the policies are important in government sector. So just to come, I have worked in three different places. I'm continuing to. So one is a central government hospital. One is a medical college that is KEM. And one is Assam, where I cannot say that, you know, something, it was individual. It was based on a very enlightened leadership, which went on and, you know, had an MOU with the state government. So the Tata Trusts and the state government of Assam had an MOU, what happened in that is the cancer care program was embedded within the preventive early detection palliation as a substratum. So everybody in oncology knows that, you know, nearly in India, at least more than 75% fall outside the curative spectrum. So, and that is all the resources are going for that small part of the spectrum, which is curative. And the other two are, you know, sort of not given adequate attention. So this cancer care program of Tata Trust looked into that. So their vision included different, you know, tiers of institutions, apex institutions, which are tertiary cancer centers, then medical college based cancer institutions, and then district level hospital based like that, and right up to health and wellness centers. So it was an extensive program. And of course, the policies It was little difficult. It was very easy for the policymakers, for example, chief secretary and health department, to understand cancer care. It was all what they wanted. And palliative care came in the way, actually, and they couldn't fully understand. And it took efforts, you know, to create evidence, you know, and that too, they have very little time. So we need to have quick, important information with solutions suggested, which should be more than one, so that they get to choose. So that, you know, we cannot give them some work to do. We have to do the work for them and go with it. For example, for opioid availability, we had translated the rules in Assamese and then went to them highlighting the important point. So, you know, we have to do a lot of double think to the government to get some policies passed. And medical colleges, they will not just entertain. They have to get an order from the DME, department, the Directorate of Medical Education. If they get an order, then there is smooth, reception. So these are the few things we need to do before we enter a medical college in the government sector. So we have started, in two medical colleges in Debrugarh as well as in Jorhat, as well as the third one is going on now. And the other one was in State Cancer Institute. And BBCI always had some amount of cancer care, but it was incomplete in the sense there was no home care, etc. So with adequate funding, the completion of that center and all happened. Now, again, when I focus on to a medical college in, say, Debrugarh, after we get this policies decided and DME order passed, and even that, you must remember that even the letter that goes from the DME has to be drafted, because they will not be able to understand what are the things which have to be included in the draft for a medical college to start a palliative care unit. So even the draft is given and then the official order comes. With that, equipped with that, we arrange for a meeting at the medical college. And in that same visit, because we are going from Mumbai to, Assam, and so we need to sensitize the faculty in that medical institution. So we make sure that it is well represented from different faculties, as well as, you know, nursing, the allied branches and everywhere. And they come and then we have to present the scope of palliative care and have enough interest created so that, and again, we need to remember that we cannot talk cancer as examples, because they see all kinds of palliative care. So we need to give examples of different types, which will resonate with different type of specialists. So all this has to be thought for. So and it has to be evidence-based because it's an academic institution. So the path to creating is, very different in the NGO sector, in an oncology sector, in a government sector, et cetera. In KEM, a long period where I went and gave several presentations through the, we have to again, in KEM, there was fortunately a Department of Medical Humanities, which fully understood the relevance of care as part of healthcare. So they completely championed this idea. So they incorporated lectures at undergraduate as well as postgraduate level. They incorporated workshops in which Dr. Marianne and her team completely participated. So we had a 2-day workshop. And then the undergraduate the education, even 2019 one contains, integrated classes on communication ethics. But even before that, in KEM, we had already integrated several of these lectures. So the students during their induction period or during internship, they have a lot of loose time which are unstructured. So, we could add on lectures during those hours. And that is the time that we could present many of these concepts. So these are the different ways in which we need to introduce in different sectors. So in Assam, it was policy driven from the central government. In KEM, it was a very, very well respected division within the institution, that is medical humanities, which completely gave the support to propagate this. And that influenced a department. And now they have opened a palliative care unit within it. And also the nephrology department took in the idea of renal supportive care. So there is a, so in another thing is in a general hospital, we need to also work with specialists because they will not refer already patients. Is hassled with a few hours of waiting or almost more than half a day of waiting. Again, to refer them to palliative care is quite impractical. So we need to go and sit there. So we sit during the dialysis OPDs. And someone talked about, I think Dr. Ranadi talked about the feel of oncologists. Where does that feel come from? It comes when it is part and parcel of the training. So I hope that these students who are listening to these concepts of disease experience. So in disease experience, I get a patient. The patient speaks about how what that person went through. So patients, the students are so active. They are, you know, they're that time fresh from the 12th standard community living, and they are asking beautiful questions. And unfortunately, by the end of internship, they become all, you know, conditioned into just looking at the part which is diseased. So the extracurricular, you know, input is very important. How your senior behaves, how they behave to the patient, how they talk to the patient. So unless we can do all those things, the feel that a specialist has for the patient may not change. So we need to equally concentrate on the training period by integrating these concepts, and they will find the answers. Palliative care just branched out because someone thought of it. So every doctor has enough knowledge and skills to at least look at where to search for treating this particular symptom. So it's just the attitude that that needs to be incorporated, and they will do the needful. Oncologists are so good at updating and upgrading themselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nandini.
Can I just put one point?
Yes, of course.
The solution to all this could be a joint clinic, like we do for many other diseases. For lymphoma, we have radiation oncologists and medical oncologists sitting together. If we can have a joint clinic with the medoncs and redoncs and the palliative care people and involve them at the earliest, I think that will be the only way out. I'm talking about private sector. I'm not talking about government sector. And my suggestion to the government sector is obviously included in the curriculum so that people will learn. And we need to train the oncologists as well as the patients. So it can't be only a unilateral thing. Patients are aware and oncologists are not. So both those things should be incorporated.
Rumana, can I respond a little to that? Is it okay?
Of course. I think we may be out of time, but love to hear from you. So go ahead.
These clinics have happened. Hello?
Yeah.
So as I told, in the government sector also, there are joint clinics, for example, in nephrology and say head and neck clinic. When I was in Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, we used to run it joint with the head and neck surgeons clinic. And that, as you say, are extremely effective. And in private sector, which I mentioned, which I did not detail, I used to take rounds with the oncologist. So oncologist will look at, you know, the patient and I'm listening and I will say, what about the motions? Has the patient, you know, passed? Then suddenly they will realize that for last 2 weeks. So, you know, we can bring in different aspects while doing rounds with them. But of course, initially, all this requires a little bit of proactive nature from the consultant. And the second part is about education of oncologists. So you may be happy to know that we are launching an educational program focused on palliative care modules within the fellowship of the head and neck surgery. So that is, you know, we have got everything set out. And that will be, as they are learning head and neck surgery, they will also have integrated modules on palliative care. So across the 2 years of the head and neck fellowship, they will learn, you know, different aspects of important approaches and principles. And of course, they will be competent enough to be more than excellent generalist palliative care doctors along
Romana,
while
just
they are being. Yeah.
Apologies, we are running short of time.
30 seconds.
Can we just have one last comment from all the panelists and just close off?
So I'll go first. Just to say that in Tata, all the joint clinics have a palliative care person. We don't have that many, but at least the residents do go to some of them. But as far as I know, Dr. Priya Kulkarni in Pune, she attends private joint clinics. So, I mean, it is happening. The thing is, I think if the oncologists would call the private palliative care people in their city on board, I think that would make a big difference.
So, Marianne, I just want to say that we also have OPDs at different hospitals. Like, for example, we've opened an OPD for Dr. Shona Nag's big oncologist in Pune. And having an OPD during her clinic hours means that it's integrating into her practice.
Yeah.
And we are finding that opening OPDs within the hospital itself, if the palliative team is embedded, then that is also one way. We can integrate care across the disciplines. Please, Dr. Purvish, would you like to add your closing comment?
I think no comment from my.
So I think Dr. we should continue. Ranade? We are short of time.
Yeah, I'll just put one thing. I think we have to work at multiple levels and rather than. Hello?
Yes.
Am I?
Yeah.
Can I?
Yes.
You're heard? Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I feel rather than having, you know, OPDs in two different places in one hospital, I would rather have one OPD, which is a joint clinic. That will have the biggest impact because the patients believe in oncologists and they then can be seen with a palliative care specialist. That would be the ideal scenario.
But for that, you have to invite the palliative care person. Don't forget, the oncologist.
Yes, we have to invite. I take the onus. I 100% agree with you on that.
We'll have to just stop.
What is lacking is the oncologists. We know that.
The discussion. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Romana.
Thank you,
Thanks.
Over to Kashish.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you to everyone for a wonderful and interactive session. We'll move on to the next session. This session is on soft tissue sarcoma. Our moderator is Dr. Ashish Gulia, surgical oncologist from Mumbai. His panelists are Dr. Sameer Rastogi, medical oncologist from New Delhi, Dr. Krishna Mohan MVT, medical oncologist from Hyderabad, Dr. Amol Dongre, medical oncologist from Nagpur, Dr. Abhishek Singh, medical oncologist from Lucknow, Dr. Akshay Shivchand, medical oncologist from Kolhapur. Over to you, sir. Sir, you have to unmute your mic, sir. Ashish, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Thanks for the opportunity to contribute for soft tissue sarcoma in this great SARC meeting. Special thanks to Dr. Purvish Parekh and Dr. Bhatt and Dr. Govind Babu for the invitation so that we can learn something about soft tissue sarcomas. My panelists, as already have been explained by Kashish, I won't be wasting much time, but I'll go ahead straight away with the first case, which is a 45-year-old female. She had this lesion in the gluteal region since 5 months, and you have the MRI images right in front of you. So, Sameer, welcome. So I think I'll start with you. And Sameer, this patient comes to a clinic. She has this primary lesion, which is growing very rapidly. What are your thoughts on evaluation, and how would you take it ahead?
Sir, I think since it is growing rapidly and it is quite suggestive of some soft tissue malignancy, I will refer to surgeon for biopsy.
Okay. So,
sir, are you having any difficulties, sir?
Yeah, it was stuck. So I think I'll just share again. It'll come up again. Yeah. Okay, so as rightly pointed by Sameer, we have multiple options at this point of time. Somebody may offer a needle biopsy for this lesion to have a correct diagnosis in the beginning. Somebody may offer it an upfront excision or a preoperative radiotherapy or chemotherapy. So Sameer has rightly said that, you know, we need to have a diagnosis first. Now, being a surgeon, I'll take this question here, that when you have a lump which are very small, which can be excised without any morbidity, we go for upfront excision of these small lesions, which are usually less than 3 to 4 centimeters. But very important point to understand for every oncologist is that the excision done is not done like a simple biopsy. We should consider them as sarcomas and always do wide excision of this swelling as we would have done in a definitive surgery. So, and that's what the principles are, that for the tumors which are less than 5 centimeters, you can do excision biopsy, and usually it is done for superficial tumors, and the bigger tumors require a histopathological diagnosis first because it may require multidisciplinary management right from the beginning. And hence we prefer coronal biopsy, which may be guided by ultrasound or CT guidance. So that was just a small question to begin with. Sameer, my next question again to you is, how you have seen institutional practice a lot in Delhi, you might be getting a lot of patients who are being referred from other private institutions. So what is your take on patients who have been treated in peripheral centers where there is no sarcoma unit or a multidisciplinary unit? Do you see any difference in their management?
First of all, starting with diagnosis, since they don't have expert pathologist, so the whole diagnosis might go wrong. Other than this, the margins are more often than not positive. Simultaneously, sometimes when chemotherapy is not indicated, they might get chemotherapy. And if not, if indicated, they might not get chemotherapy. So this is where multidisciplinary meeting is not there, or where the tumor board is not there. So there are a lot of lacunae which might happen, sir.
Akshay, your take on the same.
I agree with Dr. Samir. Basically, when they operated in the peripheral center where there no oncologist or no one sarcoma specialist available, may have they got the positive margin or just small excision of that lump, and they said to the patient that it is not a malignancy. So you go home, and they came later on after a period of 6 months with all the metastatic lesion wherever is the lung metastasis and all that. So there is a need for a multidisciplinary care, or every small excision of any soft tissue swelling, it needs to be brought into the picture of pathologist, and that care should be given.
Thanks, Akshay. So we have enough literature
Ashish,
talks.
Ashish, Amol here.
Hi, Amol. I can't see you. So I
think I can answer. Hi. I think I I'm in COVID duty, Ashish, so I can't, you know, expose myself. So
sorry.
I was not able to
see you, so I was about to ask, where is Dr. Dongre? Please go ahead.
Yeah, so, you know, I think I can answer this question quite well, because I worked in a periphery in Nagpur, and then I go to a rural hospital where, you know, there are n number of patients who just underwent a excisional biopsy. They don't care about the margin part, and then, you know, it turned out to be, sometimes it's a low grade sarcoma, sometimes it's a high grade sarcoma. So it's actually a real problem. And, you know, we in a private practice, I don't often see that much sarcoma. But since the day I started going to that peripheral hospital, no, I see lot many sarcomas, and it's really very difficult to convince them also to give, you know, to do IHC, because what we know is, like, you know, many times we tell them, okay, now we don't know the margin, let us take a radiation. And then, you know, the other colleagues are like, sir, why you need radiation for such a low grade sarcoma? So actually it's a problem, you know, for sarcoma management in a periphery. Yeah, Ashish.
Very beautifully put by actually all three panelists here. Akshay, Samir, and Amol, and has shown that, you know, just a simple procedure of excision of a superficial sarcoma can lead to multiple confusions. We are not sure about the management, and eventually, if we are planning a revision surgery, it might require a much bigger surgery with a plastic flap, and adds morbidity as well. So we should be very careful while dealing with these small lesions, which may appear very benign, but eventually may lead to a lot of disasters. So with that quick background on how do we essentially manage these patients in sarcomas, which have great outcomes if managed properly, we move on to our second case. In the 62-year-old female, she had this swelling in her forearm, which was growing subsequently since past 10 months. And it has grown rapidly from past 4 months. On examination, the swelling was about 10 into 12 centimeters, palpable, firm in consistency, and it had a limited mobility. So the biopsy we will plan, but I want to show the MRI images to all my panelists. So these are small videos of the MRI. You will be able to appreciate. That's the lesion in the forearm on the coronal sections. That's on sagittal section. And the last one is the axial section, showing a large lesion which is present in the anterior compartment of the forearm. Big lesion very close to the radius and ulna. Both the neurovascular bundles are stretched and are very, very close. So just repeating the axial once again so that you get a nice view and you can help me in planning this case. Great. So essentially, just showing you a cross section, neurovascular bundle is very closed, bones are very closed, entire anterior compartment is almost filled with the tumor. Samir, your take on such a case on first visit to your clinic, she is non-metastatic, metastatic workup is done.
Sir, biopsy needs to be done.
Okay.
And, sir, like, it needs to be assessed that if surgeon would be able to take it with negative margins.
Okay.
Or else some preoperative therapy needs to be planned, sir.
Correct. So, Sameer, the biopsy is high-grade pleomorphic sarcoma, which was done under local anesthesia. And these are the images. And this patient is non-metastatic and has come to the clinic. So what will be your thought?
Sir, preoperative radiation can be given irrespective of histopathology. And since it is also sensitive to chemotherapy, so we might give neoadjuvant chemotherapy with concurrent radiation therapy preoperatively.
Okay.
Like discussing with surgeon and radiation oncologist.
Dr. Mohan, your take on such big borderline lesions with, you know, in a closed compartment like forearm.
Yes, sir. So as I see in my assessment, I think it is not suggestible to operate upfront. I would agree with Dr. Sameer that we would go for neoadjuvant chemo radiation.
Okay. Amol?
I would go for neoadjuvant radiation rather than adding chemo. Pleomorphic sarcoma, I would add more to give just neoadjuvant radiation and then operate.
Okay. Akshay, your take?
Pleomorphic sarcoma, we can do both things, neoadjuvant concurrent radiation, or we can give a chance of chemotherapy as it is sensitive to doxorubicin.
Mm-hmm.
So we can plan I plus A for this patient 3 cycles, get the see the response, and then we can operate later on also after the 3 cycles of neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
So, sir, the reason why I proposed neoadjuvant chemo is that right now we are having a DNB thesis in our institution where we are using doxorubicin with radiation, and contrary to our previous belief, the patients are tolerating well.
Okay, so we will discuss that point as well. I have a few few slides of them. So, you know, we all debated
Sir, Abhishek this side, I am in traveling, so I don't know how much audible I am.
Hi,
can Abhishek. I make a comment?
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I was not able to see your video, so I was not sure whether you have logged in or not. Yeah, Abhishek, please go ahead. So you saw the imaging, I hope, right?
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
So, sir, it is definitely not operable upfront. Definitely, neoadjuvant therapy is required. And being a pleomorphic sarcoma, moderate chemosensitive, I would like to add chemotherapy as well. But definitely, it has to be addressed in the multidisciplinary team. Has to be decided what neoadjuvant therapy.
Great. Thanks, Abhishek. Thanks. So ultimately, what we realized from this case is that these borderline resectable patients where we are not sure whether we'll get adequate surgical margins at upfront resection, we need to do something preoperatively to either shrunk the mass or make the margins more sterile. Traditionally, the main teaching has been to use preoperative radiotherapy, or we can have multiple options like using preoperative chemotherapy or concurrent CTRT as well. So let's discuss them one by one. So preoperative radiotherapy, as we do not have a radiation oncologist, I've put up some slides to show you what exactly happens. Usually, so preoperative radiotherapy is sort of adjuvant therapy, which is indicated in all high-grade sarcomas, which are more than 5 centimeters and deep-seated, and if you cannot get real good wide margins. There have been a lot of debate about using preoperative and postoperative radiotherapy when there are no clear-cut indications of preoperative. Preoperative radiotherapy is essentially, it leads to very high rate of infections and tissue damage. Postoperative radiotherapy basically requires a larger area to be radiated and have higher doses as well. But apart from that, the outcomes, the oncological outcomes have remained the same, whether you use preoperative or postoperative. But the case per se in discussion here is that we want to use a preoperative or a neoadjuvant therapy, whether it is radiotherapy or chemotherapy, to get good surgical margins or to reduce the mass. And this was the landmark paper from Brian O'Sullivan from Toronto. Brian's is still doing great work. And he, with our surgical colleague Jay Wonder and team, have shown that the rate of wound complication is exactly double in number. But and they have started doing primary flaps for all the patients, specifically in the lower limb and thigh. And some more data from this systematic review and meta-analysis, which clearly shows that preoperative radiotherapy or postoperative, they do not provide any survival benefit, but yes, they can ease the resection as well. So we had a lot of debate, and we all know that preoperative radiotherapy is pretty standard. and we had our panelists who were discussing about neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And so essentially, Sameer, you wanted to add only chemotherapy, or you want to add both neoadjuvant chemotherapy or radiotherapy?
Sir, I wanted to add both chemotherapy and radiotherapy.
Okay.
Because there is data from Italian sarcoma group, mm-hmm. in which they have done ifosfamide, epirubicin, and radiation therapy, and they could not find increased complications. So in the end, they said there were 200 odd patients. They said that the chances is that like the we are over anticipating the toxicity of chemotherapy.
Mm-hmm.
So concurrent is probably safe. And okay. with current, sir, current radiation, the Sullivan paper was with old techniques of radiation. It was not IMRT. So mm-hmm. the
Most of the patients were with IMRT, and still they have IMRT and equal amount of complications as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So let me speak to Abhishek again. Abhishek also wanted to do concurrent, Krishna wanted to do concurrent CTRT, and they have a thesis going on in their clinic. So what was your thought process behind not doing only radiotherapy and adding chemotherapy concurrent to the radiation?
So there are two aspects to it. One is that upon discussion, we came to a conclusion that preoperative radiation is better to offer preoperative radiation, number one. Mm-hmm. Number two is for tumors which are likely to be chemosensitive, as you said in this histology.
Okay.
Adding a single agent doxorubicin, we do it 30 mg per square meter for 3 days.
Okay.
Once in 28 days. And we reviewed and we thought that would give better results and surgical outcomes also.
Okay. So do you have any specific list of histopathologies which you choose to treat with the concurrent CTRT?
So for the bottom line is all high-grade sarcomas, irrespective of the histology, and more so if it is leiomyosarcoma or things like that, which are known to be very chemosensitive tumors.
Okay. So this phase 2 randomized trial, which talks about neoadjuvant chemotherapy and sarcomas, as mentioned European trial, as Sameer was also mentioning, it clearly showed that the survival benefit is not there, but they help in resection. So that part is definitely cleared with multiple trials, that if you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy, it's not going to help you to improve survival, but yes, resectability can be improved if the histopathology is chemosensitive. And typically it is more used in round cell sarcomas and synovial sarcomas, preferably more, or liposarcomas, rather than other chemo insensitive sarcomas like MPNSTs and epithelioid sarcoma. So we need to tailor the therapy. Presently, we do not have very clear-cut evidence which shows that adding neoadjuvant chemotherapy in with or without radiotherapy provides great advantage in resectability, but it is still still to be discussed further, and then we plan. Similarly, some evidence about NACTRT. A lot of people have issues regarding the increased toxicity, and I would just like to add point here, summarizing all the points told by our panelists, that and before that, I'll go to Amol. Dr. Dongre, you said that you will not add concurrent CTRT. Any yeah. specific reasons for that?
No, normally, you know, we see that apart from the round cell tumor sarcomas, other sarcomas are not very sensitive to chemotherapy. And that's why, I mean, it's my very short experience, but whoever pleomorphic sarcomas or myxoid liposarcomas, whenever I tried giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy, they fail miserably. So I feel the preoperative radiation is a better way, and then you operate and then you give a proper adjuvant chemotherapy, and would be a better choice. Nothing more specific apart from that.
Akshay, you want to add any more point to it?
No, as you have rightly said, when patient is young and where there is a limb salvage is an option, there those histology which are highly sensitive to chemotherapy, such as synovial sarcoma or myxoid liposarcoma, where we can definitely take an advantage of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And some trials, whether it's in phase 2 or phase 3 trial, they show some advantage where these are chemosensitive histologies are there and patient is young, and probably the limb salvage is an option.
Perfectly. So essentially it boils down to each and every case, and today we are in the era of personalized medicine. So we need to treat and take this case by case basis. You need to look at the size of the tumor, its location, its proximity to the vital structures, ability of a surgeon to get you complete negative margins, and obviously the histopathology, whether it is chemosensitive or radiosensitive or not. So based upon that, we take a call, we assess each and every patient in joint clinic and then decide about it. Another point which I want to add here is in TMH, we also practice concurrent CTRT for select patients, borderline resectable patients, where we feel that, these are peripherally located, and our medical oncology and radiation oncology team are a bit wary about giving both concurrent CTRT for centrally located lesions where the hematological toxicity might be much higher. So for a lesion which is in the periphery, like below the elbow, below the knee, we can explore the option of concurrent CTRT. And rightly said by Akshay, patient has to be ECOG 1 or 0, and patient needs to be a younger patient who can tolerate the toxicity as well. So again, emphasizing on personalized care, case by case basis, and it is not the standard of care. What Dr. Amol rightly said is the standard of care. Concurrent NART or preoperative radiotherapy has much better effect on tumor resection if you are only giving for resectability. So I'll just skip this slide. We have already discussed it. So what ultimately we know that there's no clear survival benefits. It is best to be given under trial or very controlled settings in sarcoma centers. And it needs to be decided on case-to-case basis for borderline resectable patients, depending upon multiple factors, which I enumerated. Okay. So this was the post-radiotherapy MRI. I will only show you the... So we treated this patient about 3 years back only with radiotherapy. And this was the response. There was about 20 to 25% reduction in the mass. There was a nice shell of fibrosis which formed around this tumor, and we could easily excise it. So we treated with only radiotherapy, and then we will discuss what our experts feel needs to be given later on. So this is the general anatomy. You can see how close it was earlier to the neurovascular bundle. Now the tumor has shrinked only with radiotherapy, and we could excise it with negative margins. The closest was 5 millimeter and was a high-grade pleomorphic sarcoma. Coming back to Dr. Amol first, because he did not give radiotherapy. Dr. Amol, now in this second, surgeon has taken out the tumor completely with negative margins. Given preoperative radiotherapy, do you feel there is any role of adjuvant chemotherapy?
No, I don't think it's a pleomorphic sarcoma. We had a very good response to radiation. Surgeon did a good job. Even though margin closes is 5 mm, but I guess that's okay in an extremity sarcoma. I wouldn't incline
to... She is 62 years old female, otherwise healthy.
Yeah, so I wouldn't
so 5 minutes left, sir.
Any chemotherapy.
Okay. Akshay.
No chemotherapy. Yeah. No adjuvant.
Quick, your take.
I won't give an adjuvant chemotherapy for this patient. With the closest of 5 mm margin, margins are free. Patient had already taken preoperative. So, there, I would...
Samir, your take.
Subjective.
The size. What is the size? After
surgery? Size was 10 centimeters.
Yes, sir. I think should be given. Though data is not there, but should be given.
Data is not there, then why it should be given?
Sir, because they are under recruited trial. The trials are hardly, they could recruit 351 when they planned for 900. So statistical benefit in such a rare sarcoma cannot be there. But given the fact that 4% survival was seen in meta-analysis. So
she is 62. Like
sir, without comorbidities.
Dr. Mohan, your take.
I would closely follow up, sir.
Great. Thank you so much. So, we had a great debate. And so, again, this is actually a real-time scenario, and this is happening this way. There are absolutely no rigid compartments, but we know that if your patient is very young, if you have, this was the first meta-analysis which we spoke about with marginal benefit. There were some more specific trials added to it with ADRIA and IFOS. And this was the EORTC trial, which did not show benefit. And Samir was also talking about that it was underpowered. And the best possible evidence what we have today is SMAC 2008, which shows that there is some benefit to it. But in which patients, we need to decide. And how we come to the criteria is younger patient, histopathology, which is chemosensitive. You have close margins of tumor, deep-seated large tumors. These are the tumors where we can sort of get into MDJC and then decide about chemotherapy. Now, I have less time. Quickly, I will go and ask this question straight to Dr. Sameer Rastogi. Sameer Rastogi, we know that there are a lot of new agents. We know you have studied on pazopanib. You are a very aggressive medical oncologist who use newer agents as well and this target therapy. What is your take? Now, upfront for soft tissue sarcoma as first line, these new agents are available. Do you think there is a role for giving or trying targeted therapies in first line as adjuvant therapy in soft tissue sarcomas?
Sir, it totally depends on histology. Most of the time, ifosfamide and doxorubicin remain the standard. But in case of less like epithelioid sarcoma, then tazemetostat should be the first line because it provides very less toxicity, though response rate are low, but prolonged response rates are there. Similarly, other newer agents like eribulin, trabectedin, in second or third line, they might be tried. In angiosarcoma, taxanes might be tried.
My question is about first line.
For first line, in majority of cases, apart from alveolar soft part sarcoma, epithelioid sarcoma, angiosarcoma, majority of time it is doxorubicin-based therapy. Majority of time.
Abhishek, sir, your take. If Abhishek is not there, then
I will not use them in the first line. I would rather reserve it for the second line, third line.
Okay. So one of the big papers by Gronchi et al., who showed that, you know, if we had a head-to-head comparison, and they again stated that a doublet of dox ifos still is the standard of care, and we should be very, as put by Sameer rightly, that we should be very careful in choosing patient whom we want to start this targeted therapy. This is not the standard of care at present, but yes, in rare situations where we do not have, we have a chemo insensitive histopathology like epithelioid sarcoma or alveolar soft part sarcoma, then we can explore these options upfront as well. And I think we need to generate more evidence for this and then take a call further on. And this was, in short, the conclusion of the study. Last question to all my panelists. A metastatic recurrent lesion with bilateral metastasis, your choice of agent which you want to give for palliative setting, whether you want to give single agent, double agent, your choice of agent and reason. I will start with Akshay.
She's 56-year-old female.
She's 56, recurrent lesion, PS1. She has metastatic lesions, bilateral lung nodes.
Yes, she had already received IFOS Adria. So I left with the gemcitabine based or docetaxel gemcitabine would be my option, a doublet, because she is preserved, well-preserved, PS1, 56, relatively young patient. So I prefer a doublet agent over a single agent.
Sameer, your take.
Sir, since patient has already received ifosfamide and doxorubicin and pazopanib has not been given, we can either use pazopanib and gem-docetaxel synovial sarcoma, it's not effective. Only 5% response rate is there.
So these are the two main options available in today's scenario, which we can explore if patient has already received the main dox ifos upfront, and these can be used as second line. Now, last question to Amol, Abhishek and Krishna. This lady, she's 65-year-old, had a huge recurrent lesion with bilateral undissectable pulmonary and nodal metastasis. How will you palliate her? The best way you can palliate her. Mohan, yeah.
Single agent liposomal doxorubicin.
Why liposomal? Why not standard?
The trials have shown that regular doxorubicin, liposomal doxorubicin, both are equivalent. It is well tolerated as compared to doxorubicin.
Abhishek, your take.
I agree with him. Single agent liposomal doxorubicin, well tolerated and equal efficacy.
Amol, your take.
Absolutely. Single agent liposomal doxorubicin. I think it's the treatment of choice, Ashish.
Okay. Sameer, let me quickly reverse this question to you. Tell me a scenario where you want to give a doublet.
Sir, where we want good response, like subjective, more than 15-20% response, and patient is very symptomatic, then we use doublet. Otherwise, there is no point using doublet, sir.
Great, great. So this is how we have summarized quickly in 30 minutes. So if we have a patient who is really symptomatic, a large, and you want a quick response first, then you can actually, and patient can tolerate, is a young patient, then we can start off with a doublet, and then, you know, Otherwise, single agent doxorubicin have equivalent effect, but in rare scenarios, we use double agent as well. So thank you so much being with me in these 30 minutes to put on some nice messages, evidence-based messages on the management of soft tissue sarcomas. Thanks to all my panelists for contributing very actively. And thanks for SARC Educational Committee for giving all of us this opportunity to be here on this dais.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, Dr. Ashish.
We'll move on to the next session, which is the debate. The topic of the debate is what is ideal venous access to deliver systemic anti-cancer therapy. Our first debater is Dr. Ghanshyam Biswas, medical oncologist from Bhubaneswar. He's going to talk for PICC. Over to you, sir.
So, yeah, good afternoon. So, Ashish, are you going to present the slides?
Sure, sir. I'll present the slides.
Hi, Hemant, sir. Hi, Ashish. Anish.
Hi, Dr. Ghanshyam. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
May the best man win. Amish, all the best to you too. May the best man win.
So first of all, thank you, organizers, for such a wonderful meeting. Right. So what is the ideal venous access to deliver systemic anti-cancer therapy? So my pick will be a pick. Next. So definitely in this COVID times, two things have got famous and lots of contribution from Purvis Parikh sir and Kabina. So the pickup has been the piking, that is the Novartis effect, and picking definitely the bird effect. Next. So what can really go wrong with BIB? So here you can see, so both me and my colleague Amish is here. So as a co-authors, so to make a long story short, and this got published in 2004. So where you can see a necrotizing fasciitis in an acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So when any of this CBD was not used. Next. So life's too short to learn from your own mistakes. So learn from others. Next. So the options for chemotherapy infusion. So on the upper side, you can see, so definitely not the hand upper limbs, which is already probably has gone wrong, or not neither the lower limbs, but still many of the colleagues in many cities in the country still use, where they are not still convinced or they don't have a support for a CBD. So definitely the options of central line pick and chemopod is there. Next. So the perception of CBD, so for a patient, for the patient attendants, for the caregivers, and for the medical fraternity can be, is it required? Is it important? But I think that is totally an integral part today. So there are many ignorant patients, there are many ignorant caregivers today, and definitely there are insurance issues. So cost, complications, and maintenance are some of the factors that comes into play. Next. So the type of CBD, we know that non-tunnel, tunneled, implant, chemoport, which Amish will talk next. But what I'm supposed to talk on the peak is there since 1975. Next. So the consideration while deciding for an ideal venous access, so it can be a patient factor, it can be a tumor factor. We know there are drug factor, and definitely, so what regimen you are choosing. And besides that, there are certain other factors that will also play a role. Next. So we know that types of chemotherapy which are to be concerned and where next. So the vesicants and the irritants listed. So ideally we should consider CBD for all the above drugs mentioned. Next. So the issues with the PIB need to change periodically, repeated punctures, thrombophlebitis, infiltrations, and hematoma, and those mentioned in the red one. Next. Extravasations, bleeding. Next. Nerve injury and arterial puncture. And so probably you have to take help of Dr. Purvis Parikh sir for the legal issues that can come up, and we know the stories. Next. So the lack of venous access may prevent continuum of chemotherapy for patients. So around 2/3 of the patients receiving any of the irritant or vesicant experiences phlebitis, and 1/5 of the patients receiving such drugs can experience a different grades of extravasation. Next. So the global guidelines, next. So next, so from the MAGIC, that is Michigan Appropriateness of Guide for Intravenous Catheters, for those for peripheral IV cannula not recommended for non-peripherally compatible infusions like the vesicants and irritants. So PIC can be recommended from day one to long term for long term usage. So no differential recommendations between the PIC tunnel catheter and the port. And definitely for more than 5 days, so PIC is preferred, not the port. Next. The second is from the Infusion Nursing Society. Next. So if you see their recommendations, so PIV is not recommended for any irritant or vesicant drugs, even for the parenteral nutrition. So for this, so day one to day 12 weeks, so PIC is preferred, and more than 12 weeks, so PIC and port can go side by side. So for non-irritant and vesicant, so more than 4 weeks, so PIC is preferred. Next. So timing of the dwelling of the catheters. So ASCO, PIC line is intended for patients requiring for more than 12 months. So PIC from the NHS, PIC indwelling time ranges from 7 days to 34 months. From the MD Anderson, it can suited for treatment lasting for few days to many years, and PIC can also stay in the arm for more than 12 months. Next. So these are some of the international papers. On the left hand side, you can see, so 269 catheters for 250 patients. So 98% of them are solid tumors. So median dwelling time ranging from 184. So the ranges from around 3.5 years. So another paper publication, so around a year or so. Next. So this is one of our Indian publication from Dr. Gauri Kapoor and et al. So this was 101 pediatric patients. So you can see, so median catheter time was almost 6 months, and there are patients who continued for 9 months plus. Next. So the Grossenbach three ways. So negative pressure helps in the blood aspiration, positive allows infusion, and neutral pressure so remains closed. Next. So that helps to reduce the risk of ear embolism, catheter, and the risk of blood reflux and clotting, and so needs weekly saline flushing, so you may not have an heparin flush. Next. So there can be early complications. So in war, good guys can sometimes become bad guys. Next. So late complication. Next. So there are enlisted next complications. So malposition, so maybe a more common in the next. So not a right candidate, so where you can go for Kempot. Next, last slides. So the experience in Spurs, thanks. Next. So my team, and thanks to Sister Mary and the Bird for this. Next. Next. So around 470 catheters, PIC line since 2013, 55 in this COVID time. Next. So only 4 chemo port during this COVID time. Next. So over the years, we have increased in the number of PIC. Next. Next. So summarize. So PIC, though it is a short procedure, so most of the time for last 3 years, we have moved into an ESG guided. So chemo port, we know that it is a long duration. You require an OT, you require a surgeon. So for PIC, so we have trained our pharmacist, we have trained our male nurses and resident doctors. So definitely for our centers, so almost 1/4 the cost of a chemo port, maintenance is easy. And so there are patients who have gone for almost more than a year plus. So complications are less with a dedicated team. Next. For removal, so you don't require no cost. And today the BARD has come up with the Portia. So Odisha is yet to get. So our nearby state has already received it. And that's helpful for the patients who cannot come on a frequent basis. Next. So now I pass on the baton to Dr. Amish. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now we'll have our second debater, Dr. Amish Vora, a medical oncologist from New Delhi, who's going to be talking in favor of chemoport. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Can I share my slides?
Yes, sir. Please go.
So am I audible and am I visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ghanshyam. We call Ghanshyam Dada. So how can we ever debate with Dr. Ghanshyam? And the topic was, Dr. Ghanshyam was about to speak for PICLINE and I'm supposed to speak for Chemoport. So I'll try to do that in next 6 minutes. I thank the organizers and Dr. Parikh sir for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to speak about port. So as you can see that the port chamber is in the anterior chest wall. The vein entry is in the subclavian vein. And the end of catheter is at the junction of SVC and right atrium. So Chemoport, I'm sure all of you have seen, some people who have not experienced, it's a central venous access device. There is a port and there is a catheter. The port has septum in which a specific needle, Huber point needle, is introduced. Chemoport insertion is done in operation theater under local anesthesia with sedation if required. Actual procedure time is 40 to 70 minutes. Same day admission, same day discharge, same day chemotherapy can be started. 2 days local site pain persists and then subsides. Chemoport can stay inside the body for 10 good years as compared to 1 year, as Dr. Ghanshyam mentioned about the PICLINE. Now, this is how the final post-procedure look in Chemoport happens. And on my right-hand side, this is what the final procedure post-PICLINE it looks like. Chemoport can be used for injections, infusions, blood transfusions, TPN, antibiotics, and also for contrast CT and MRI. Sometimes we refuse to use PICLINE for that. Maintenance, as Dr. Ghanshyam mentioned, needs flushing only once a month. No external dressing is required. Very minimal chances of infection or thromboembolism. It is travel friendly. Does not interfere in day-to-day working. I just wanted to quote this article Dr. Govind Babu sir has published with his colleagues, a very, very detailed comparison of PICC and PORT. I wanted to congratulate him for that. Let us look at few other hard facts and evidence what we have. In 2015, ESMO clinical practice guidelines, if you see the bullet point third, PORT is provided for long-term use and associated with low risk of infection. And the last bullet point where I have highlighted, the main limitation of PICLINE is shorter longevity, mainly because of high risk of thrombosis. PORT in government setting, is it feasible? So this is a very nice article from Gujarat Cancer Research Institute, where after taking ethics committee approval, they have presented and published 100 patients data on Chemoport. Not only they have said that this is feasible in India in government setting, but extremely low complication rate in this. One of the proponents of PICLINE say that pediatric patients, it should be only PICLINE. So it's a very good article from US. 2,600 catheter experience was compared. Infection rate lower in Chemoport arm, p-value 0.0002. And venous thromboembolism lower in Chemoport arm 0.0001 and highly statistically significant. As Dr. Ghanshyam mentioned, I also have my hope experience during COVID times only. 40 patients with Chemoport and 23 patients with PICLINE came to center during COVID times. One out of 40 patients with Chemoport had pus collection and had to be removed, while 5 out of 23 PICLINE unfortunately had complications, out of which only one fracture could be repaired, 4 had to be removed. This tells us the maintenance, which was not possible during COVID times. So we know complication rates and the infection rates are low. Let us look at the ease of insertion, maintenance, quality of life and cost. 0.4% failure rate in Chemoport as compared to 15% failure rate in PICLINE if you don't use ultrasound, and 6% if you use ultrasound. 60% success rate in single prick in Chemoport compared to 30% in PICLINE. 26% more pain perception in PICLINE insertion as compared to Chemoport. These are all published data. Dr. Ghanshyam, I'm not making up these data. Maintenance requirement. Once a week with PICLINE, sometimes twice a week required, while once a month with Chemoport. Dressing with PICLINE requires 15 minutes. If complication is present, as simple as there is no backflow, minimum 30 more minutes are required. Of course, patients' relatives can be taught, but the data suggests 40% complication rate if the dressing is done by parent compared to 12% by nursing staff. And in Chemoport, there is nothing to break from outside. Let's look at the cost, the holy grail, the big proponent of PICC line. Extremely good article from China in 2017. What they showed that if you compare the cost of maintaining PICC line versus chemoport at the end of 12 months, both turn out to be the same. It includes complication rate, includes antibiotic, it includes radiology in case because the PICC line thromboembolism and infection rates are higher. So my last three slides, just close your eyes and imagine you are not able to take bath for 6 months. You are not able to wear half sleeves in 40 degree temperature, not able to swim, not able to drive, not able to lift weights. Wherever you go, people look at your PICC line and say, oh my God, are you suffering from cancer? As an oncologist, when we are counseling patients for PICC line and chemoport, see, all of us use both. And if the patient is affording, close your eyes and think, what catheter do you want patient to pick up? And my last imagination for you people, during COVID times, patients with PICC line versus patients with chemoport, what do you think is easy to handle, easy to maintain, less hospital visits, less complications? Finally, as it was seen in Indiana Jones movie, you must choose, but you choose wisely because decisions can determine patient's destiny in our case. So choose chemoport as and when feasible. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. We'll now move on to our expert, Dr. Hemant Malhotra, medical oncologist from Jaipur. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Kashish. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So many thanks to Dr. Govind Babu and Dr. Amit Bhatt for stitching together this wonderful program. And we've heard two great lectures from two top medical oncologists, Dr. Amesh Vora and Dr. Ghanshyam Biswas. No medical oncologist, or in fact, no oncologist will deny the importance of good central venous access in chemotherapy patients, particularly in which prolonged chemotherapy is a planned, say, for example, patients of ALL, patients of AML, patients who have to receive 12 months of trastuzumab, patients who have metastatic disease and a chemo-responsive cancer in which, you know, after one line, two lines, three lines of chemo goes on. And of course, for patients who have thin veins and for pediatric patients. Both the modalities which we have today, PICC lines as well as the chemoports, they have their own indications, they have their own complications. And that has been highlighted by like both the speakers and two fantastic talks. So if I were to give a judgment on who's the winner, I think both of them are winners. Both of them are very dear friends of mine. Both of them have done more than justice to the topic given to them. And it is just a question of which patient requiring which intervention and what kind of expertise you have in your center. And again, an extremely important thing to remember for all of us is that once you insert the device, whether it's the PICC line or the port, the proper care of that, adequate access to that is extremely important. You just hate if there is a complication in the PICC line, and you hate even more if there is a complication in the port. So whatever device you use, specific devices for specific situations, both our debaters are right in what they have said. Once you do insert the device, please make sure that you have a team and you educate the patient and the relatives adequately for the care of the device. So it's been my honor to kind of give you these thoughts of mine accumulated over 30 years. And it's been a pleasure to listen to and interact with Dr. Ghanshyam and Dr. Amish. And all the best for the remaining conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your such kind expert comments and kind words, sir.
Thank you so much, Hemant, sir. Thank you so much, Amish, sir, and also Ghanshyam, sir. We'll move on to the next session. This is the academic session 10. It's on gynecology. Our moderator is Dr. T. Raja, medical oncologist from Chennai. And the panelists are Dr. Ashish Joshi, medical oncologist from Mumbai, Dr. Amita Maheshwari, surgical oncologist from Mumbai, Dr. Chetna Bakshi, medical oncologist from Mumbai, and Dr. Sandeep Batra, medical oncologist from Gurugram. Over to you, sir. So you'll have to unmute your mic, sir.
Am I unmuted? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Thank you. I thank the organizers I thank Dr. Govind Babu, Dr. Amit Bhatt, and Parvish Pai Kavina Creations for presenting this wonderful opportunity. And it's a great privilege to be with all of you. This is an academic session update on ovarian cancer. Given the next 30 minutes, I'll try to cover 4 key questions, but I've elaborated into 12 questions of 2 minutes each. We have 4 panelists, 3 medical oncologists and 1 surgical oncologist. So the 12 questions were so that they can set the context. So this will be the first slide and the first question. I may go to Dr. Ashish Joshi. And this slide shows that the daughter, Angelina Jolie, she's a known BRCA1 carrier. And she had a double mastectomy and a bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. And the background is that her mother, Marceline Bertrand, was also a famous Hollywood actress. And she had breast cancer, but she actually died of ovarian cancer at the age of 56. So my first question goes to Dr. Ashish. She got her first surgery done in 2013. So Dr. Ashish, if she had come for a second opinion with you, what you would have advised for her, Dr. Ashish?
So we cannot hear you, sir. Can I request you to remove your earphones if possible, sir?
Can you hear me now? So when you're looking at risk reductive procedures, as far as the germline BRCA mutation is concerned, we have 3 protocols. One is we can have an annual MRI, breast MRI. We also have a risk reductive bilateral mastectomy. And we also have now some data of using tamoxifen as a risk reductive procedures. But the impact of surgical mastectomy has been so punchy and deep that you could have the risk reduction to the level which is less than an average population woman, which is less than 7%. So hence, I believe that risk reductive bilateral mastectomy possibly has the best outcome in terms of risk reduction in terms of BRCA and breast cancer is concerned.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. Dr. Chetan, Angelina Jolie, in the year 2013, when she was age 37, she undergoes a double mastectomy because she was supposed to have 87% risk of developing cancer. The maternal history is that mother died of ovarian cancer and the grandmother died of ovarian cancer. That was the actual maternal history. And 2 years later, after she learned that there are some possibility of early ovarian cancer, she went through a preventive in 2015, salpingo-oophorectomy. Because she was advised that she had 50% risk of developing ovarian cancer. Her aunt, who is the sister of her mother, who had the same BRCA1 defect, who could not, at that point, scientifically could not take the preventive approach, actually died of cancer later. So Dr. Chetna, you would also agree with the opinion that she got and with Ashish's opinion. What is your second opinion on her story?
Yes, sir. Actually, I agree with Dr. Ashish, whatever he said, because the best results we get with is with the surgery. So I agree with him.
Thank you. So now we will move on to the upfront treatment in the ovarian cancer. And we know that all of us know that the ovarian cancer is not a single entity, heterogeneous. And again, if you take the epithelial ovarian cancer, if you are looking at the high-grade CRS, mucinous clear, we learned that each one of them is being driven by different pathways. And this was from a 2013 catalog in the cancer research. But at that point in time, all these varieties of disease in the name of a single entity, ovarian cancer, all of them received an upfront paclitaxel as the standard option, as the single option. The best option. That's what in 6-7 years ago. And much has changed over the past 7 years. And so I'm turning to Dr. Sandeep. What are the most important changes that have happened in the treatment of upfront treatment of advanced ovarian cancer, Dr. Sandeep?
So the three most important changes that I think is the importance of R0 surgery. That's an optimal debulking surgery whose importance cannot be undermined. The second important thing will be the establishment of the clear-cut role of a platinum-based chemotherapy. And third will be the BRCA. These three, I think, are the most important thing, but underlying is a very good pathology which tells us about the grades of the tumor so that we can actually predict the response to the treatment.
Okay. So, I mean, you know, the landscape has changed from primary debulking surgery to a possibility of neoadjuvant chemo followed by, you know, interval cytoreduction. And then the interval cytoreduction is also plus minus accompanied by HIPEC and addition of bevacizumab. And then, you know, first line maintenance with PARPi inhibitors. These are the major changes that have happened in this field. So, Dr. Ashish, you would agree with these changes or you want to add or any of anything else?
Yes, I completely agree with you. I think understanding of the genomics of ovarian cancer, I think that has got a sea change in our understanding of this whole biology of the disease. And now probably we are looking at a genomic landscape as BRCA mutated, or we would probably go on to a step further as a homologous recombinant repair deficient tumors vis-a-vis non-deficient tumors. And you probably have now two active agents, one a bucket of PARP inhibitors, and obviously the bevacizumab drug to be chosen from. And obviously, you know that the data is quite impressive, and you probably could make alteration in the outcome of a patient by dividing this patient genomically. And that's, for me, is the most important impact in the ovarian cancer treatment.
Thank you. HRD as a basket, we'll come to that a little later. And I'm turning to my surgical colleague, Dr. Amita. Surgery or neoadjuvant chemotherapy first. So I have cataloged all the most important randomized controlled trials. In this, you know, the first three went through a Cochrane meta-analysis, and then came the latest one, Scorpion. So there are four published RCTs where you can have the data set. Dr. Amita Maheshwari, what is your take on surgery versus NACT?
Yeah, hi, thank you. So as you already put these this slide, so at least four randomized trials in advanced epithelial ovarian cancer confirmed no survival advantage from upfront cytoreductive surgery in patients who had advanced disease and increased perioperative complications. So I think we can say there is level one evidence in favor of neoadjuvant chemotherapy in advanced stage 3C and stage 4 ovarian cancer. Now, having said that, I want to just, you know, stress upon the point that not every patient with so-called advanced ovarian cancer receive neoadjuvant chemotherapy. In fact, every patient should be evaluated by a gynecologist. And if patient factor or disease factors allow, patient should undergo upfront cytoreductive surgery. Only when patients are not suitable because of disease or because of poor performance status or other factors, these are the patients who were actually included in all these trials, and these are the patients where neoadjuvant chemotherapy should be practiced. So we should not swing from one extreme doing surgery for all, upfront surgery for all, to another extreme giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy to all advanced ovarian cancer.
Thank you, Dr. Amita, for saying that it is not an all or none law at this point in time. So here is the data. And the data says that the PFS and OS is by and large the same in all of that. And the inferiority, non-inferiority or superiority, nothing has been confirmed. But certain subtle points have been already observed. So you pointed that out. But as a clinician, I have to make a day in and day out decision. That's the problem. So Dr. Sandeep, you know, are there any defining way you would look at that this to be not a surgical candidate? In other words, I'm trying to qualify the definition called defining unresectable disease. Of course, we're going to turn to Dr. Amita once again, but Dr. Sandeep, your version.
So for me, the only absolute contraindication for a primary cytoreduction is the surgeon itself.
If the surgeon decides an R0 resection is not possible, that's the definitive contraindication.
But sometimes, you know, patients ask you, doctor, what do you think, isn't it? Surgeon, of course, is going to give their opinion. So let's go to the surgeon. Dr. Amita, is there any defining criteria that you're going to call it as unresectable?
Right. So maybe we can divide two major categories. One is patient-related, poor performance status, low albumin, elderly patient associated comorbidities, which, you know, maybe contraindication for aggressive surgery or infrastructure in terms of post-operative, perioperative care. So these are the factors. But apart from that, disease-related factors, yes, if just to put it in a very concise way, if in my opinion, based on pre-operative evaluation, especially on CT scan, if I think optimal cytoreduction, at least to less than a centimeter, is not possible, that will be one contraindication for doing a front surgery. And we have laparoscopic Fagotti score, which we don't use, but a diagnostic laparoscopy can be used in borderline cases. We just put in a scope and decide whether optimal off-front cytoreduction is possible or not. That's something in between we can, you know, avoid morbidity of a major surgery.
Absolutely. So that is another section called role of diagnostic laparoscopy. And I think you've already elaborated, wherein you are clear that you are not going to achieve a complete cytoreduction or an R0, and 1 centimeter is a good thought. And there are other things like, if there is an intestinal deposit and so on and so forth. So there are some definitive criteria which can clearly shift the patient from one end to the other. This was published last year, October 2020, the Scorpion data, the last of the 4 RCTs, which also agreed with the previous 3 that that's the way to go. So while you are at it, I'll begin with the other controversial area. HIPEC, as we know, is much touted. Dr. Van Dryal's paper in NEJM 2018 talked about a recurrence-free survival of 14 months versus 10.7 months and an overall survival advantage of 45.7 months versus 33.9 months. And here I've shown the overall survival, and I'm here showing the DFS and the OS. There are some questions. Dr. Amita, I have heard you earlier, if I'm not wrong, that you were not in favor of HIPEC, but I can stand corrected. What is your opinion on HIPEC, when and where?
So, I have my doubts on, changing my practice based on just one randomized study of 245 patients, which has many methodological flaws and has been, many controversies. In fact, the most interesting part of this study is the center which contributed maximum number of patients. Actually, there was no benefit from HIPEC in this study. So I think it's an interesting concept which needs further, more investigation before we can say it's the standard of care. And another thing important to remember that in this study, only stage 3 patients were included who had achieved optimal cytoreduction to less than 2.5 millimeter or less at interval debulking surgery. So we should not practice HIPEC, even if you want to believe in this trial, in patient who had stage 4 disease upfront, because in stage 4, there is absolutely no evidence, even at interval debulking surgery, in favor of HIPEC.
Thank you, Dr. Amita, for clarifying that. Turning to the maintenance therapy, which is, I would take this, as concurrent and maintenance. Bevacizumab is a concept. Dr. Ashish, has it changed the landscape for you? And of course, we know GOG218 set the platform, but I think ICON 7 had its say, it's a final say, as of now. What are your takes, Dr. Ashish?
Yeah, so obviously we know 2 trials, GOG and ICON 7. And if probably I could succinctly put it, those patients who are not optimally debulked there were in GOG, actually there were 4 or 5 parameters, like even pre-treatment, median CA-125 level, ascites, suboptimal debulking. These were the factors wherein the bevacizumab maintenance added a PFS benefit, But ICON 7 actually showed that probably it's the suboptimal debulking is possibly the only factor wherein there is a yawning advantage of adding bevacizumab. But if you see both these trials, the curves actually separated initially and then they are fused. And that's where our limitations happen here, wherein you could probably think two times before using bevacizumab as a routine standard of care for a bevacizumab maintenance. Also coming to the dosages, wherein you have one study of 15 milligram per kg, second of 7.5 mg per kg. So we are not clear on that as yet. But still, in a clinical setup, I tend to use it for a patients who are suboptimally debulked. Then I tend to use it as a combination with chemotherapy first and then use it for a period of 1 year. And I tend to use a dosage of 7.5 mg per kg. And this with a disclaimer that BRCA is still not in the picture. Probably BRCA would change because what the studies also have shown that patients who have BRCA wild type, which traditionally has got a poor biology, they tend to get benefit with bevacizumab vis-a-vis those patients who are not BRCA mutated. And now BRCA mutation coming in and the olaparib data coming in, probably the equations would change. But as far as the GOG and ICON 7 is concerned, this is my consensus as far as the maintenance bevacizumab is concerned.
Yeah, also I can add that, you know, one of the trial, it went on to give the maintenance for about 15 months. The other one would define it as something like 12 cycle. And the ICON 7 is important because 90% of the patient finished the intended treatment. So it's kind of a true data.
Yeah.
And it stood out that the ascites and more than 1 centimeter, as you pointed out, and clearly the stage 4 are the patients who benefited with definite PFS advantage, no OS yet. You're right. So can we change anything more? So I can ask Dr. Chetna, do you think immunotherapy upfront is an exciting option? Here I'm presenting that is atezolizumab data. The IMAGNIN 050 failed to show a PFS benefit in which atezolizumab was added along with carboplatin. And then the durvalumab, wherein the durvalumab in various ways, you know, duo O trial is on. Do you think this is going to make an impact, Dr. Chet?
Sir, at least till now, benefit has been very, very modest with the upfront treatment of immunotherapy. So I think we need to wait for the results. At least as for now, I don't think so. Immunotherapy we can use as an upfront treatment for these patients.
Sure, agreed. So the real impact at this in this setting has come from the PARP inhibitors, as you have heard from the Dr. Ashish and Dr. Chetna. Dr. Sandeep, coming to you, maintenance therapy with olaparib and solo one trial published in 2018 and says this clear PFS advantage and 70% lowering of the risk of death. This was published in 2018, NEJM. And of course, this is the this was presented last year ESMO by Dr. Banerjee. And you know, this shows this even at the near 5 year point, this is the PFS advantage that we are seeing. Dr. Sandeep.
Yes, sir.
So is this your automatic choice?
Yeah, definitely. I think the adoption of PARP inhibitor in the maintenance has been unprecedented. All patients at they are getting BRCA tested at the diagnosis or later at the end of the treatment, and all eligible patients are being advised maintenance treatment because this is a drug which has given 70% PFS benefit for a use of 2 years. So I'm a firm believer of this drug in the BRCA1/2 mutated setting. And though the percentage in the Indian population varies from 12 to 25%, but still about 1/5 to 1/4 of the patient do derive benefit from this treatment as maintenance.
Okay, so you would use it for germline BRCA or for anyone and everyone, Dr. Sandeep, while you ask
the question. So in the first line for the germline BRCA mutated, though the trials enrolled some somatic BRCA mutated also, in the second line onwards, all subsets, whether it is germline or somatic BRCA mutated.
Okay, Dr. Ashish, what about niraparib? The PRIMA data shows PFS benefit. This is the data here, and one other important thing about PRIMA data, you definitely know that, but I'm just presenting it for the sake of everyone else. So there were subset analysis on HRD deficient patient, and also HRD with wild type BRCA, but HRD deficient and HRD proficient patient. All of them showed benefit. So do you accept this and can you explain this, Dr. Ashish?
So this is very interesting data, sir. And in fact, this HRD was defined on the proprietary genomic instability index of more than 33. And if the genomic instability index is more than 33, then you are defined to have a, you know, HRD deficient tumors, and they were supposed to respond to nilaparib. So I think it's the molecule. It's probably a stronger PARP inhibitor and probably a hazard ratio, as you could see, even in a BRCA wild HRD deficient tumors, the hazard ratio is close to 0.65, which is very, very impressive. But having said so, I still stick my neck out and say that I probably won't use nilaparib in a BRCA wild type in a first line setting. I would still wait for more data to emerge, but this is very interesting and probably fascinating data. And you probably could have a larger group or larger ambit of patients who could be included in a PARP inhibitor study beyond BRCA, because
initial hesitancy, that is across the Indian subcontinent. Be wary, take it with a pinch of salt. Dr. Chetna, to you.
I just want to make one comment. It's not only initial hesitancy, but it is difficult to believe. So as you rightly said, how can we explain? It is difficult to explain, sir.
No.
We have got the results. Okay, I agree. We have got the results. But explanation is little difficult. Why it will be helpful in all the cases, right?
So kindly explain this data. The nilaparib plus bevacizumab significantly increases the PFS. And here is what it is. And in the HRD positive patient, there is a definite impact with the doublet. And HRD negative patients, there was no impact. So that, does that fit with the logic story, Dr. Chetna?
Yeah, I mean, they are acting like synergist in HRD positive with BRCA mutation patients. I don't know the logic, but this data really, Paula, one data really looks very good. Addition of bevacizumab plus olaparib.
Fine. So then I know this is the summary of all of them. Look at this in HRD positive patients, whether they have a tumor BRCA positive or negative, but HRD positive, you will see that the Paula 1 data is positive and the Prima is positive and the Velia, yes, which is the veliparib, yes, is also positive. But then the Prima has been, as we are all struggling to explain HRD negative data. So that is what it is. But currently the FDA has approved olaparib in the germline or somatic BRCA mutations in the first line. Olaparib in combo with bevacizumab is approved if you can provide a companion diagnostic for olaparib. And bevacizumab is approved as a first line in combination for any patient, actually. That's the FDA approval. And niraparib is approved for following a CR or PR for any patient. That's as it stands, the 2020 approval of niraparib. So
Dr. Raja, can I just make a quick comment? So are you not bothered about not having olaparib alone arm in Paula trial, and thinking of adding BEV to olaparib? What will be your take from this study if you have to? So there is no olaparib alone arm here.
Yeah, your point is taken. I think the Paula was actually built on the solo trial, isn't it? So yeah. Therefore, that's how they built it. The solo has clearly established undisputably established that whenever there is a germline mutation or even a somatic mutation, and some of us are willing to extend it to the HRD positivity in the first line. So that is setting. That setting is set. And
my concern is there is no olaparib alone arm here. You are comparing, you are having BEV with or without olaparib. So that's...
Now that is, I think there is a, I'm not very sure. There is currently a particular trial happening in that there is a particular arm. I'm not very sure about it. I don't want to sound all knowing, but your point is taken, Dr. Amita. And so this is the 2020 paradigm, as was presented by Dr. Banerjee in this last ESMO. And she has nicely summarized where we stand and what are the additions that have happened in the first line. And now, but coming to the recurrent disease, we have been always deficient. We have been concentrating on various therapeutic options in the recurrent disease, but the question is going to be different. In the platinum sensitive setting, the GOG213 had two questions. One was bevacizumab or not. That question is not relevant today for our panel, but the second question was randomization to surgery versus no surgery. And in the recurrent platinum sensitive setting, surgery was a safe option, but did not improve outcome. So Dr. Amita, to you, surgery in the recurrent setting, where do you stand with that?
So again, we have two randomized trials with the opposite results. So GOG213 is here, which did not show benefit from surgery, but you have desktop 3 where a surgery has shown benefit both in recurrence-free and overall survival. So I don't know the reason. One could be a desktop used a very stringent criteria for selection of patients. So patients who had no gross residual disease at upfront primary surgery. So these were not neoadjuvant patients. All patients had surgery upfront, no gross residual disease, platinum sensitive. A median platinum free was around, I think, 23 months. And these patients had performance status 0, and then ascites if present less than 500 ml. So a very, very stringent criteria was used. And other thing, I think BEV was not used, or it was in less than 15% of patients in desktop, as opposed to more than 80% patients in GOG213. And the criteria there was very loose. It was based on physicians' perception, and it was left to physician to decide whether patient is suitable for surgery or not. So I think these two could be the reason.
4 minutes left, sir.
The 2 minutes. Yeah, thank you. We'll finish. Don't worry. See, the AGO criteria as defined by Professor Du Bois made all the difference. You put it very nicely. So therefore, there is a PFS and OS if you follow. And this is again the Memorial Sloan Kettering criteria for selecting patients. This for people who want to look into it. But then you have already presented that. And I come to one of the important, Angelina once again did something else. She published an editorial in the New York Times in 2013 after her surgery. And later on, Time puts up this particular cover page. I mean, this is several years later, and they would call it as an Angelina effect. What was Angelina effect? That was a 3 times increase in the testing of BRCA and an exponential increase in the awareness of BRCA, and the myriad losing the patent for BRCA gene. That has really revolutionized, and that's what she did. She went on to then, after scalping oophorectomy, she went on to adopt children's. And so this is what she has contributed. So identifying risk, but can we extend this preventive option, Dr. Ashish Joshi, to everyone, including PALP-T? What is your thought?
So obviously it is not for everyone. It is for a subgroup of patients. And as what we would see in the guidelines, that all patients with epithelial ovarian cancer of high grade serous histology would qualify for germline BRCA testing. Those patients who have got a non-serous but mucinous histology would qualify for somatic BRCA in case if required. But it's not for all. It's for high grade serous epithelial ovarian cancer is wherein you would test the patients for a BRCA.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. As we have only one more minute time, I am not going to take the last question on PARP inhibitor resistance. Just want to give for everyone, if PARP and platinum inhibitors or platinum resistance, PARP inhibitor resistance, you have the ATR inhibitors come in a big way. Last year's presentation on this ATR inhibitor and the folate receptor alpha inhibitor, again, last ESMO, Onyx as the first proof of concept last year. These are something exciting. And what Angelina went on to do is she added more and more children, and she has now collected 7 of them as her children, and the children have grown up, and she has gracefully aged, and these are her grown up children last year. And she is now about 46, 47. She has not only conquered the disease, but she has established the concept of motherhood can be there even without the ovaries. And again, prevention as a most important concept, I would really attribute, tip my hat to this lady. With that, I thank everyone, organizers and my panelists for your wonderful discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Before we move on to the next session, we'll just have a short video from our supporter. So we'll move on to the next session. This is the rapid fire tour. The topic is the most important single publication from your country. And first we have from Nepal, Dr. Arun Shahi, medical oncologist. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your kind introduction. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible in the slides.
So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Parikh sir and Govind Babu sir for this opportunity. As like we have given the task to present a very, the publication which will cover all the issue of the South Asia. We know that like whenever we are seeing the patient and prescribing the drug, we need to always think about the cost. So there was a very nice publication of one of my friend Sivaram Khatiwada, Rajaram Dongana. And they have published this paper in Frontiers in Public Health. It was published in 21st June 2019, estimating the direct cost of cancer treatment in Nepal. As we know, the increasing prevalence of cancer and lack of a strong health financing system in low-income countries like Nepal is exerting an enormous financial burden on cancer patients. However, this is a very, small scenario. So for this, why this thing is very important is because the objective of this study was to estimate the direct cost associated with the treatment of cancer on the patients attending a tertiary cancer hospital. That is one of the government hospital now recently, Bhaktapur Cancer Hospital in Nepal. So this is a quantitative cross-sectional study and 294 cancer patients receiving treatment from Bhaktapur Cancer Hospitals between 17 November 2016 to 13 February 2017 were taken. So there are two variables, mostly the medical cost. The medical cost included the cost of consultation, diagnosis, and treatment, whereas non-medical cost included the cost of food, travel, and accommodation. So if you see out of this 294 patients who were asked from the verbal questionnaire, that majority of the patients were within the age group of 50 to 59 years, and most of them were the female, and most of them from the rural area of Nepal. And the monthly income of the most of the patients, like 45.6% of the patients, were up to 20,000 Nepalese currency per month. And the most common disease among those participants were the lung cancer, followed by breast and cervical cancer. And the duration period was 6 months and above, and 41.8% had the duration of less than 6 months. If you see the characteristics related to the disease, payment mechanism, and experience of financial hardship of the participants, we found out that most of the patient did not utilize the government support. That in Nepal government, if anyone is diagnosed with a cancer, they provide 1 lakh Nepalese currency. And they found out that only 33% of the patients utilized the government support. And the most of the method of the payment was from the out of the pocket. If you see the data that most of the patients took the loan, and 78.2% of the patients took the loan, and 40.29% sold their property for the treatment.
So and 1 minute.
Seeing the, I mean, the, utilizing the cost, the 80.91% was the direct cost was due to the medical cost, that is cost of treatment including medical therapies, diagnostic and treatment. And 19% of the cost was due to the non-medical cost. So in conclusion, like medical cost contributed the most of the direct cost, and out of pocket was the dominant payment mechanism to utilize the health service. And average direct cost of cancer was higher than the monthly annual income of the patient. And direct cost of cancer was alone sufficient to cause the medical catastrophe for the patient. So from this, what they recommended is like, it is useful for the policymaker to allocate resources for the cancer care and to improve the health financing along with the preventive and curative strategies to adopt. We need to protect people from cancer and subsequent financial hardship, and expanding government's financial support, strengthening the insurance program, and increasing tax on tobacco to fund the cancer care has to be implemented by the government. Thank you for your.
Thank you so much, sir. We'll move on to the next country. Representing Bhutan, we have Dr. Phoop Sering, ENT and head and neck surgeon. Over to you, sir.
Hello.
So you'll have to unmute your mic, yes.
Yeah. Am I audible, please?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
In sharing my slide, can the organizer please do it for me?
Sure, sir. I'll just do that.
So thank you for the opportunity, and in the interest of time, I would straight away go to the presentation. So this from Bhutan, this population-based cancer registry report, which compiled data from 2014 to 2018, is one of the most significant cancer document we have at the moment. Next, please. There is a rising incidence in cancer in Bhutan, but there is no reliable data. So the initial reports on cancer in Bhutan is all based on estimates, and it's not comprehensive. And cancer is one top disease for which we refer the patients to outside countries, especially India. And we need to understand the true burden of cancer in Bhutan and also to optimize our scarce resource. So therefore, a population-based cancer registry was initiated in 2014. Next, please. The data was collected from many sources, including those patients whom we have referred to India. And we have also gone through other areas of data collection. Next, please. So we have specifically trained data abstractors who travel throughout the country every 6 months. And two surgeons were particularly trained in that data collection, especially from the regional referral hospitals. And data was collected from 2014 to 2018. The most challenging task was to clean the data, which took more than a month. But fortunately, we had the support of IRC, Regional Cancer Registry Hub in TMC Mumbai, who helped us a lot to publish our first cancer registry report. Next, please. So this is the kind of population pyramid that we have, which is similar to any other developing countries. Next, please. If you look at the cancer, if you look at the cancer prevalence in on a yearly basis, we have an average of about 550 cases with almost equal numbers of males and females. Next, please. So this is the distribution by age and sex. If you see with our elderly people, of course, they are more affected, which shows a similar trend like any other countries. Next, please. And when we look at the top cancers affecting our population, the stomach cancer was the leading cancer, followed by cervix and head and neck. And then, of course, these are other top 10 cancers in Bhutan. Next, please. So if you specifically look at the leading cancers in males, then stomach cancer is number one, and followed by esophagus, liver, lungs. And of course, it is the fifth one is head and neck, but somehow, since subsites are divided, there is a division between oral cancer and other larynx and hypopharyngeal cancer. Next, please. And if you look at the leading cancers in female, then cervical cancer tops the list, followed by, again, stomach, breast is rising, and thyroid cancer and ovarian cancer, the fifth. Next, please. The cumulative risk, of course, is again high in stomach cancer for male and cervical cancer for female. Next, please. When we divided the ethnicity among three groups in Bhutan, and we have seen that stomach cancer, esophageal cancers are more common from western part of Bhutan, and we normally attribute that to our habits and especially the dietary habits. And people who are in the east, they come with higher incidence of cervical cancer and thyroid cancer. And breast and lung is more common among the southern belt, especially where we have higher prevalence of smoking. Next, please. So if you look at the age distribution, again, in males, it is more towards elderly after 50 and 55 plus of age, and especially stomach and esophageal cancer. Next, please. And females, of course, it is the cervical cancer and even the thyroid cancer, which is even affecting the younger population from age 30 plus up to 45. Next, please. We also compared our registry data with some other registries around the region, especially when we compare to the world registry, our AR is very less. But somehow, when we compare with other neighboring states of India, north, especially the northeastern states, we have a comparable kind of AR per 1,000 population. Next, please. That was for males. And the females, again, especially since we have a higher incidence of cervical cancer in the region, it is again comparable with other Indian northeastern Indian states.
Sir, request you to please conclude, sir. We're running short of time.
Okay, last slide. Can you move on the last slide? So, actually, I this cancer registry is an initiative of our first gyne-onco-surgeon, Dr. Ugyen Somo. So, I have to thank her for letting me to present this, and she is the lady in the middle who is the principal investigator for this cancer registry report. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now we have the last part of the rapid fire. Representing India, we have Dr. M.V. Chandrakant, medical oncologist. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. So good evening, everyone. And I would thank the organizers for providing opportunity to present on a small data from our own hospital. So as we know, head neck cancers in the West and head neck cancers in India are a lot of difference. The difference is in the burden of disease, the site of disease, oral cavity being the most common, and HPV negative is what we see when compared to the Western population. And this is a study where they have shown nearly 78% of them in recurrent metastatic head neck cancer present with symptomatic disease. So the head neck cancer, what we see in clinical trials in the West are totally different from what we see in real world in terms of its site, in terms of its burden and symptomaticness. So we all know that any metastatic cancer, overall survival is an important endpoint. We do agree for that. But the situation is so critical that head neck is required for multiple functions like speech, swallowing, taste. All these are very important. So because in Indian population, they present with heavy disease burden, having response rate and progression-free survival become more important surrogate endpoints in addition to overall survival. So just mere improvement in overall survival without much response rates would not be a great way to go. So this is the sequence. We had initially single agent chemo, then combination chemo, then we had the extreme regimen, which has been there for a long time, where cetuximab with a platinum 5-FU, and then we had immuno in second line, then we had TP extreme, where 5-FU could be taken out and we could use taxane, platinum and cetuximab. And then there was no such data of sequencing, of using first cetuximab and then using immunotherapy in a big way in Indian setting. So these are the response rates that we have seen with cetuximab-based regimen, starting from 36% to nearly 77% from the Indian study. And this is the overall survival values that you see lower down. So at present, after the pembrolizumab has come in the first line, we have these two options. Should I use cetuximab-based therapy first and then immune checkpoint, or immune checkpoint first and then cetuximab? So this is what we have. So this is the data from our own hospital in Calcutta and also from Delhi. We had a double institution retrospective analysis of small, around 54 consecutive patients for platinum sensitive recurrent metastatic head neck cancer from August 2017 to May 2020 at two centers. So we used weekly Pakli carbo cetuximab for 12 cycles maximum followed by cetuximab maintenance. And we did evaluate every 8 to 12 weeks with RECIST with proper imaging. So non-progressive patients were continued on cetuximab maintenance. The objectives were overall response, PFS 1, 2, overall survival, and toxicities. And this is what we could capture from the data. We had 54 patients total. And what we could see is nearly 79% of them had some response if you could give this particular combination. So what we have been seeing is if you can put a taxane, platinum and cetuximab, that is a subset where we are having maximum responses, and we can see the PFS one of nearly 7 months. And in those patients who progressed, when those who had logistics, they were put on nivo, and those who did not, they were put on oral metabolomic therapy. So this was, we had a PFS one of 7 months, and we had a response rate nearly 79%, and the median overall survival of the whole population was 15 months. And this is the slide in the subsequent line. If we expose them to nivolumab versus oral metronomic, you can see the clinical benefit rate of nearly 85% versus 60%. And if I can properly sequence Pakli carbo cetuximab followed by nivolumab in subsequent line, we can achieve an overall survival of nearly 20 months. So this was... it was the first time where a sequencing study was done, and we could attain an overall survival of 20 months by using Pakli carbo cetuximab followed by immunotherapy in subsequent line. So this is the first study from India on sequencing of cetuximab followed by immune checkpoint inhibitors. Even though we have data on immunotherapy in frontline setting, we have a lot of challenges on the PD-L1 or the CPS scoring and the chance of hyperprogression. So all these are issues. So the good things were, it's a double institution study. This is the first real world data on sequencing of agents. And we did have a small number of patients retrospective, and we did not do a PD-L1 expression. So first line Pakli carbo cetuximab followed by nivolumab forms the standard of care in our group of population. So there was another similar study from Japan. They also had similar overall survival of 20 months in proper sequencing of cetuximab followed by immune checkpoint inhibitors. So the hallmark things of cetuximab is the PD-L1 and the CPS is not required. And we all know that pembrolizumab basically is effective in CPS more than 20. That subgroup where the CPS is 1 to 20 is mainly driven by the higher CPS score. So because of different biology, disease burden, response rate being an important endpoint, and now that we have a sequencing study, so using frontline Pakli carbo cetuximab followed by immunotherapy could be a standard of care in our set of population. We have concerns of hyperprogression, low PFS, OS, CPS reliability in Asian population if we use checkpoint in the frontline setting. Thank you.
The request. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Now we'll move on to the next session. This is the Urish White, our chairperson, Dr. Ajay Bapna, medical oncologist from Jaipur, and Dr. Purush Parikh, medical oncologist from Mumbai, to please invite our orator and also introduce the topic. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Kashish. Avirup, apologies first for the slight delay in your oration. Your oration is the highlight of the program and we are very much looking forward to that. For those who are not familiar with our world-renowned speaker, Dr. Avirup Guha, he is a specialist from USA who has been kind enough to agree to give this oration. Of special interest to us is his expertise in cardio-oncology. And we very much look forward to him not only giving the talk today, but also guiding the Asian Cardio-Oncology Society ahead. So over to you, Avi.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so you can see my screen appropriately shared?
Yes, sir. So we can see this.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Kurvish and Ajay, for inviting. So far, very good meeting, and I actually enjoyed some of the talks which will help me build on this talk which I made. So the topic given to me was, is it right time to build the SARC cardio-oncology program? And I was going to talk about why and how. So I'm an assistant professor of medicine at Case Western Reserve University at Harrington Heart and Vascular in Cleveland. I have no disclosures relevant for this presentation. As you know, cardio-oncology program is a combination and a partnership between cardiology with hematology and oncology. And our general goals is basically to reduce the delay in cancer care, to support the treatment of cardiotoxic therapy, and to focus on prevention of development of cardiotoxicity, and finally collaboration to establish data and also clinical help in taking care of patients. So for the why section, we're gonna talk about the 4 points, which is important to know before we talk about how to develop. Number one is increase in number of cancer survivors. Number two, increasing number of cancer therapies and complexity of care. Number three, increasing shared risk factors of cancer and cardiovascular disease. And number four, specifics to SARC, the demographic transitions, which will help design a cardio-oncology program. So the number one point is the increasing number of cancer survivors. As you notice, there has been a barrage of cancer survivors at various age groups across many years. This data was published in 2018, and it's very clear that by 2040, alone in the United States, there'll be 26.1 million cancer survivors, which means it'll be much higher in the SARC countries. This is a little dated slide, but we do see that a lot of the survivorship comes from various different cancers, not one specific cancer. And we do see that there's certain cancers which have achieved greater success, mainly because they were not as fatal to begin with at 5-year time point compared to some others which were. And some data which we just saw earlier shows how we have achieved this success over the time period. Specific to just the population distribution of the world, this data on here and the one before, United States contributes only 5% of the population, rest of the world 47%, and then all the Asian countries contribute 48%. So that is a perspective to keep in mind looking at data forward. So this is a figure which was generated. It's a little dated, but there's certain concept over here which I want to go over. It's called the mortality rate to incident rate ratio. So if you can, for example, imagine incident rate of a cancer, suppose there are 1,000 people and 100 people develop cancer, so then the incident rate is 10%. Now, of the 100 people who develop cancer, if 5 people die in a 1-year period, then the mortality rate is 5%. So if you divide the 5% to the 10%, your MR to IR ratio is 0.5. So higher the MR to IR, the worse off you are. So basically, in India, it is at 0.74 for males and 0.65 for females. For Sri Lanka, another SARC country, 0.74 and 0.61. Just in comparison to the United States, it's 0.38 to 0.36. So we are getting there, but it's definitely a number below one, which means we are doing very well from the cancer care standpoint, hence increased survivorship. This is how cardio-oncology, at least if somebody would ask me the question, meant in 2000 would mean. There's anthracyclines causing cardiotoxicity, this radiation-induced heart disease, we all knew about it, studied in medical school. This is 5-FU toxicity causing ischemia, vasospasm. These are the main things talked about and probably the most commonly available care for around the world. Now, this is what cardio-oncology looks like in 2020. this is a whole iceberg, because a lot of agents, which is in phase one, phase two clinical trials, are not even on this list. And I'll share this slide. I'm not going to go over details of each of these agents, but a lot of these agents are used in India. A lot of these agents are used in all our countries, and many of these agents are in clinical trials in these countries. So obviously important to focus on what cardiotoxicity these can cause. On the left is our terms or acronyms for developments in the field of cardiology. On the right, this is probably more relevant to this audience. These are the different terminologies known by cancer doctors. In the field of cardio-oncology, we obviously need to know both and what's going on in both worlds, but it is very hard to keep up with, and hence development of a field of cardio-oncology is important. Specifically focusing on checkpoint inhibitors, the CTLA-4 inhibitors, a type of checkpoint inhibitor. These are, as of 2018, the number of clinical trials going on around in the United States and outside in just checkpoint inhibitors. Over 2,000 trials actively recruiting, and the number is higher now since there's probably a trial opening every other day in at least Case Western with checkpoint inhibitors. And checkpoint inhibitors cause a lot of toxicity. They affect every single part of the heart. They can cause conduction problems. They can cause pericarditis. They can cause myocarditis. And recently we've learned it causes atherosclerosis and speeding up of atherosclerosis. So that brings to the third point, shared risk factors. Cancer and cardiovascular disease have been linked with epidemiological studies over years, as cardiovascular disease being a risk factor for cancer more recently, and then cancer being a risk factor for cardiovascular disease, as we all know. And a lot of risk factors, namely obesity, tobacco use, physical inactivity, gender, race, genetics, are all risk factors which speed up the process. And the field of cardio-oncology will help understand the connection of how we can risk reduce for both and not just one, so that overall survival increases. And that, in my mind, is the true meaning of the word overall survival. On the right, we see some cancers, and this is more relevant for, I guess, the cardiology audience, that many cancers, specifically GI cancers, are caused by obesity. So going to a recent publication, this is just published in December, where the global burden of diseases was identified as the reasons for CVD death. And you see, India has had increase in risk factors from 2010 to 2019. And then if you see the risk factors which have gone up are cardiovascular, which need reduction, and hence the shared risk factor burden is actually going up, namely high blood pressure, dietary risk, high cholesterol, air pollution, high body mass index. All of that is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease and also cancer. So this is specific to SARC, which is important to keep in mind while thinking about development of a cardio-oncology program. There's an increasing population, hence there's increasing cancer and then increase in number of survivors. There's the aging population because of development, which also leads to more cancer, hence more survivors. There's improved access to non-invasive testing, so earlier detection of cancer, then treatment, survivors. Elderly population coming out of the cultural bubble, which is basically getting westernized, getting accustomed to getting some every 10-year colonoscopy and things like that to get into getting diagnosed early and then survivorship. Reduction in mortality from competing causes like infection. Cancer transition to lifestyle-related compared to infection-related, for example, cancer due to obesity in gallbladder compared to gastric cancer from H. pylori. Change in social and cultural practices due to education and empowerment of women, hence diagnosis of cervical cancer earlier. Increasing prosperity leading to obesity and then obesity-related cancers. And then better screening because of many of the reasons stated above. So this is how a cardio-oncology program is developed. It's a combination of education, combination of development of guidelines, prevention and lifestyle measures, and a lot of research at basic translational and clinical. And all of that comes together for patient care from both cardiology and oncology side. Number one determination, this is more from an organizational standpoint, not the whole SARC standpoint, is identify your local patient population. See what resources you have and how to best deliver the care. And it's a joint discussion always between cardiology and oncology to have a successful program. Next question is, how do you hope to achieve it? And what is your 10-year, 5-year plan? What's your mission? And the mission generally should be to eliminate cardiovascular disease as a barrier to effective therapy in cancer patients and survivors to begin. Vision is that every center should write their own vision. It is not a statement which is true for all centers. So this is how a practice model works. And the one in the center is what is more common in the United States, where it's a joint program by cardiology oncology in the cancer center, where the cancer patient generally comes and flows through the oncology clinic followed by cardiology clinic and out. I think what is more relevant and can be started right away is a cardiology staff oncology communication type of clinic where the cardiologist sees the patient and then talks to the oncologist, or the oncology staff meet one with the cardiology communication where the oncologist see the patient and talk to the cardiologist for questions. The problem obviously is that the lack of communication can be a major issue there. And then depending on the specialist they see, the focus would be that type of practice. So it might not be a wholesome care. So there's an importance of nurse coordinators. We feel that because the field is getting more and more complex, somebody who speaks both languages should be a part and play a role outside of the physicians, given how busy the practices are. So it is important because the nurse coordination can work for patient and staff education, help in coordination of care, and triage urgent cardiovascular issues. Then there's importance of developing specific pathways so that, you know, if 90% of the treatment is structured, then rest of it can be unstructured specific questions. So this takes care of a lot of redundant care which the patient might end up receiving. So the referral patterns get better because they know that, okay, I can send you my CLL patient, or I can send you my patient on a BCR able TKI, which we do have pathways for. You can just take a pathway from another organization and just start doing it as long as it's feasible. It standardizes care, it can standardize collection of data, and then assessment of clinical outcomes from that data becomes standard. This is, I'm not gonna again go through each of the specific points on the slide, but cardio-oncology is getting wider and wider. We include cardiac amyloidosis, and obviously there's whole sessions about cardiac amyloidosis. Evaluations patients with before stem cell transplant, cardiac mass evaluation, pericardial metastatic evaluation, then post radiation to the neck. I mean, head and neck cancer is common in the SAR countries. There's arrhythmia, syncope, autonomic dysfunction to evaluate that. That all comes under cardio-oncology. Another form of important, as you can imagine, it's a broad specialty, which includes a lot of oncology history. So the importance was to create a format of evaluation, and we have been working on making sure that there's a standard format of how we evaluate these patients, how risk stratification is done. So that, again, you know, you hit the 90% target of making sure it's standard across the board, so that if another oncologist receives this cardio-oncology patient, they can start taking care right away, and similarly back and forth. So the evaluation includes first accounting for CVD and cancer risk factors, then to make a list of all the cancer medications which causes all kinds of dysfunction so that we can keep an eye on it. We obviously ask for standard cardiovascular and oncological symptoms. So we have a compendium of those. Then the imaging is based on the type of cancer and the type of pathway they go into. A common imaging, which is generally done in all cardiology patients, would be an EKG. Some of them get echoes as well. Everything listed onwards and beyond is more of like depending on the type of cancer, type of the clinical question. There's lab tests, which is quite standard. We are looking into doing more and more research on biomarkers and specific types of labs which can help risk stratify patients further more than the traditional ones. There are certain medications which is specific to centers, which can be started like dextrosoxine for anthracycline cardiomyopathy versus just ACE inhibitors for people starting trastuzumab, which is available everywhere. And then we talk about the preventive measures, and this is where the nurse coordinator sort of is like, you know, takes the patient off the appointment, and then you sort of go to the next patient, and then they take care of counseling for tobacco cessation, heart healthy diet, exercise as a therapy, and maintaining ideal weight. So this is a proposed service line. This is how it generally would work. And again, this is more based on the fact that your cardiology clinic is located in the cancer center, so may not be very relevant for a SAR practice, but this is what we imagine. It's an oncology service, cardiology service, endocrinology, nutrition, exercise therapy, vascular medicine, nephrology, onco primary care, psychiatry, pharmacy, nursing. They all get together to create the service line. It starts with the diagnosis of the cancer. We plan and help plan. Cardiology helps plan the high-risk therapy, including sitting in the tumor board. Pre-existing cardiovascular disease risk factors are discussed to decide on therapy where there's a choice. Then the treatment plan is based on what are the high-risk treatments being given? And then new cardiovascular problems while on treatment is identified and mitigated.
And we try to de-escalate chronic cardiovascular conditions as much as possible during therapy so that that doesn't become a problem. And eventually the survivorship line, where prior exposure to high-risk treatments are accounted for, and we do a mitigative therapy to prevent any complications. Cardiovascular risk reduction is a focus in survivors. And then treatment of chronic cardiovascular disease and condition continues as a. So this is important. This word is important to spread because cardio-oncology is a growing specialty. The first thing is when you develop a cardio-oncology program is the routine direct communication with your oncologist. Phone calls, attendance at oncology service line meetings, tumor boards, the electronic medical record wherever is there, their EMR nudges to refer to cardio-oncology at the right time. Telehealth has become very important, especially in the era of COVID. And then community engagement like this one, where we are talking about cardio-oncology, where it's a lunch and learn, and we discuss why cardio-oncology is important, what the services are offered, and how we can take care of cancer patients better. And then attending local and national meetings. There's the meeting for ICC, which is coming up, which can be very educational to everybody wanting to get into cardio-oncology. And I'll talk a little bit about the Asian Cardio-Oncology Society, which was launched earlier in 2020 in around September, even before that for the planning group, where so far the focus has been manifold. Number one focus was education, and a lot of very nice lectures and lecture series was done, which if you heard all of them, you'd get about level one, level two type of knowledge in cardio-oncology. And there's a movement towards developing more and more fellowships, at least in the United States and United Kingdom, as I know. There's a focus on research, but there should be focus on research on regional differences. A lot of data which we see is from the Western countries, and there's clearly differences in genetic risk factors and local risk factors, which are not accounted for in those studies. So it's important to sort of do at least small studies in the SAR countries to focus on seeing if the risk factors for developing cardiotoxicities would be a little different. There's also a requirement for guideline development focused on SAR countries. For example, there's a movement to do strain imaging on patients with cancer. Now, strain imaging, even at the best cancer hospitals over here, sometimes not reliable because it requires a very good echocardiographer, very good image to then derive strain off of. It's a second level derivation. How about using an excellent biomarker and doing research, which can be done everywhere, and it is more reliable. So it's something like that, which would be more relevant to SARC than just taking the ASCO guidelines and following it straight. And then obviously it's an early day of this organization, and it's focused on agenda building. We have monthly meetings, monthly research meetings, where we discuss how to take the organization forward. So in summary, cardio-oncology is a specialty with multiple reasons of why it should be embraced. Successful cardio-oncology program focuses on collaboration and team approach to care. SARC-specific program should be focused on data gathering as a first step to determine need. Cardio-oncology program development must be tailored to practice. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Avirup. That was a fantastic exposition on the subject. I really liked your statement of lunch and learn, because I think that's a great informal opportunity for us to, you know, learn so many new things that are happening all the time. We also, on behalf of ACOS, we thank you for guiding us. And your summary slide on ACOS was absolutely apt. It describes exactly what we have been discussing in our monthly meeting. And I'm sure that ACOS leadership will gain immensely from your expertise and connections, particularly since you are also involved in the International Cardio-Oncology Society. I will stop here and request Dr. Ajay Bhavna to give his comment as the co-chair. Over to you, Ajay.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Yeah, it was really a pleasure to listen to Dr. Avirup. We have listened to him during our ACOS meetings also. And this was the exact question which I had put to Dr. Govind Babu. So he had agreed that, we should have some kind of consortium for SAR countries also, because first we need to actually tell them and disseminate the information about the cardiotoxicity of the various drugs, then this targeted therapy and immunotherapy, and then we can take a second step, because automatically it will develop the interest in the cardio-oncology. So I really thank Dr. Abhirup Guha to really put the things in correct perspective. Since this is an oration, so we will not invite any question and answer. And I thank Dr. Purvish Parekh, Dr. Govind Babu, and Dr. Amit immensely for making a part of this meeting. Thank you very much.
Over to Dr. Govind and Dr. Amit for the final comments, please.
Thank you so much, chairpersons and Dr. Abhirup, for this wonderful oration. And before going on to the next SFO business meeting, let me just thank a couple or two people over here. One is who has been the backbone of this entire scientific sessions, respected scientific chairperson, Dr. Purvish Parekh, sir. He's been meticulously planning and doing all the sessions. So thank you so much on behalf of the president and secretary of SAARC Federation of Oncology. I really humbly thank you. And second is the soul of SAARC Federation of Oncology, Dr. Baraya. So thank you so much, sir, for always the support. And you have been always a standby with us, and you have been supporting us for and encouraging us all the way. Thank you so much. And lastly, I would thank Kashish and Kavina Creations for this wonderful audiovisual experience which we have been having.